जानसी मैम।
हाँ यस मैम।
हाँ प्रेयर संग मैम।
His presence. Small cheer and great welcome makes a merry feast. Now I invite dear madam, Dr. Jansi Rose, librarian of our college, to welcome the gathering.
Education is the most powerful weapon which you can use to change the world, says Nelson Mandela. Respected dignitaries, learned professors, research scholars, and my dear students, good morning to one and all. I am really privileged to have the pleasant task of welcoming the distinguished gathering for the national level NET preparatory program organized by St. Ignatius College of Education Autonomous Palayam Kottai in collaboration with the District Central Library Palayam Kottai Tirunelveli. On this beautiful morning, first and foremost, I invoke the Almighty God to shower His blessings throughout this program. As we all know, there is nothing more attractive than a great positive personality. Our Reverend Sister Dr. L. Vasanthi Madonna, ICM Educational Counselor and Assistant Professor of Mathematics, is a great personality. Her simplicity, smile, intelligence, hard work and genuine character has attracted many souls. I am extremely delighted to give you gracious welcome, dear sister. A great mind produces great men, but only the heart is able to guide them on the best way. I also have a very special person to be welcomed, and that is Reverend Sister Gemma, ICM, new secretary of St. Ignatius College of Education, Palayam Kottai. She is a person of great values, and our institution is blessed to have such a prestigious person. A grateful welcome to you, dear sister. Real leaders are ordinary people with extraordinary determination. Yes, our beloved principal, Dr. M. Maria Saroja, Research Director and Assistant Associate Professor of Biological Science, is a real leader, a dynamic person, and an able organizer who maintains an intimate relationship with the members of the group and has the wisdom to motivate them to maximize their potential. I feel really honored to give you a cheerful welcome, dear ma'am. Next, I would like to welcome Mrs. R. Violet, Librarian Grade 1, District Central Library, Palayamkottai, who always reminds the good values and takes the role to guide the young minds in the right path. Welcome, ma'am. Never stop learning, because life never stops teaching. I consider it a great honor to welcome Mr. Muthukrishnan, former librarian, District Central Library, Palayamkottai, whose enticing attitude towards learners makes everyone to approach him at ease. Welcome, dear sir. An investment in knowledge pays the best interest, says Benjamin Franklin. I feel proud to welcome all the resource persons from various prestigious institutions and from the prestigious Institute of St. Ignatius College of Education, Palayamkottai. On behalf of everyone gathered here, I welcome you all.
Thank you, ma'am, for your fabulous welcome. One tree can start a forest. One bird can frame a goal. A true leader has the confidence to stand alone. The quote above said is very much apt to our principle. You show love and give guidance. Your endless care, guidance and support prove that you are a great leader. Now I like to call Dr. A. Maria Saroja, principal of our college and convener of this program, to present the keynote address. Welcome you, ma'am.
Thank you, Vanilla, for your kind words. The most respected Reverend Dr. Vasanthi Madonna, our educational counselor, the most respected Reverend Sister Jemma, the secretary, St. Ignatius College of Education, respected Miss Violet, librarian, District Central Library, Palayamkottai, Mr. Muthukrishnan, former librarian, District Central Library, respected resource persons of the national level UGC NET preparatory program, Dr. Velmurugan, Dr. Sasipriya, Dr. Sherlin, Dr. Veliyappan, Dr. Maria Prema, Mrs. Lily Maria Praveena, Mrs. Stella Rajakumari, Mrs. Debashila Jennifer, Mrs. Bhuvaneshwari, Mrs. Michael Jayapriya, dear Dr. Indra Mary Edilselvi, Dr. John C. Rose, Mrs. Lily Maria Praveena, the organizing secretaries of the national level UGC NET preparatory program, learned professors of St. Ignatius College of Education, my dear scholars and my dear student teachers. We all agree that the ultimate goal of going to college is not only just to get the degree, but to land a career as well. If you are aiming to make your career in research or teaching field after completing your post-graduation, then UGC NET 2021 is the perfect gateway to achieve your goal. Education is one of the subjects in which National Testing Agency conducts UGC NET to fill the recruitment of junior research fellowship and lectureship in government and private universities. Every year, many students apply for the UGC NET education exam because of various career opportunities available, but only a few of them can accomplish their goal. It is very clear that NET exam 2021 is going to be conducted to determine the eligibility for the assistant professor and junior research fellowship in Indian universities and colleges. Prior to 2018, NET exam was conducted by Central Board of Secondary Education, but now NTA is the in charge on behalf of the UGC. The NET exam was initiated by UGC, and later the CBSE conduct the NET in 84 subjects at 91 centers across the country. From December 2018 onwards, the responsibility of UGC Central Board of Secondary Education has been transformed to National Testing Agency, which has been established as the premier and autonomous testing organization for admission, fellowship in higher educational institution. We all know very well that currently the exam is being conducted twice a year in the month of June and December in online mode. My dear scholars, to prepare for the exam, you must have the best UGC NET coaching and study material. This will help you give your preparation to your right direction and score better in the exam. Taking into consideration of all these important points, we have organized this national level UGC NET preparatory program for the paper education. The program will help you to get the tips and advice from the experts that will help you in the UGC NET exam. And the experts will provide you the best study material, previous year question papers with solution, model test papers, syllabus. Our aim is your success in the exam. So prepare well and get closer to your dream of becoming lecturer or JRF. Dear participants, your intellectual contribution is very much needed for the successful conduct of the national level of UGC NET preparatory program. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am, for your clear-cut keynote address. முத்துக்கு பெயர் போன தூத்துக்குடி மாவட்டத்தில் உதித்து நூலக தகவல் அறிவியல் முதுகலை பட்டம் பெற்று பின் மூன்றாம் நிலை நூலகராய் பணி அமர்வு, தம் கடின உழைப்பு கடமை உணர்வு ஒரு சேர தேனி மாவட்டம் இரண்டாம் நிலை நூலகராய் பணி உயர்வு, விடாமுயற்சி தன்னம்பிக்கை, முடிவு முக்கடல் சங்கமிக்கும் குமரியில் முதல் நிலை பணி உயர்வு, பரணிப்பாயும் நம் நெல்லை தரணியின் மாவட்ட மைய நூலகராய் சுயநலம் பார்க்காமல் பிறருக்கு ஆற்றும் ஒவ்வொரு உதவியும் மனிதநேயம் என்ற உணர்வோடு இளைஞர்களின் வழிகாட்டியாய் புத்தக திருவிழாக்கள் பல கண்ட பகலவனாய் வாசகர் வட்டத்தின் வாடாமலர் திருமதி வயலட் நூலகர் கிரேட் ஒன் மாவட்ட மைய நூலகம் பாளையங்கோட்டை அவர்களின் நட்பணிகள் பல நிலைத்து நிற்க வாழ்த்தி தொடக்க உரை வழங்குமாறு அன்புடன் அழைக்கிறேன். மேடம்,
Ignatius College of Education, UGC NET preparatory program online meeting துவக்க உரை ஆற்றுவதில் நான் மிக்க மகிழ்ச்சி அடைகிறேன். நமது கல்லூரி மிகவும் சிறந்த ஒரு கல்லூரி, லட்சக்கணக்கான ஆசிரியர்களை உருவாக்கிய கல்லூரி. ஆசிரியர் பணிக்காக படிக்கிறவங்க அனைவரையும் நான் வாழ்த்துகிறேன். இக்கல்லூரியில் படிக்கும் நீங்கள் அனைவரும் சிறந்த ஆசிரியர்களாக விளங்க இறைவனை வேண்டுகிறேன். முன்னாள் ஜனாதிபதி டாக்டர் ஏ விஜய் அப்துல் கலாம் அவர்கள் ஜனாதிபதியாக பதவி ஏற்கும் போது அவ்விழாவில் கலந்து கொள்வதற்கு தனக்கு படித்து கொடுத்த ஆசிரியருக்கே முதலிடம் கொடுத்தார். பின்னர்தான் தனது குடும்பத்தினருக்கு இடம் கொடுத்தார். ஆசிரியர் பணி அறப்பணி, அதற்கே உன்னை அர்ப்பணி என்பதற்கிணங்க அப்படிப்பட்ட சிறந்த பணிக்கு அர்ப்பணித்துள்ள உங்கள் அனைவரையும் நான் மனதார வாழ்த்துகிறேன். இந்த ப்ரோக்ராமில் டிஸ்ட்ரிக்ட் சென்ட்ரல் லைப்ரரியையும் இணைத்துள்ளதில் நான் பெருமைப்படுகிறேன். இந்த ப்ரோக்ராம் சிறப்பாக அமைய இறைவனை வேண்டி தொடக்க உரையை ஆற்றுகிறேன். நன்றி. ஹலோ,
தேங்க்யூ மேம் ஃபார் யுவர் ஃபேபுலஸ் இனாகுரல் அட்ரஸ். வித் மச் ஆனர், மே ஐ நவ இன்வைட் அவர் மோஸ்ட் ரெஸ்பெக்டட் அண்ட் பிலவட் செக்ரட்டரி Reverend Sister A. Jemma ICM and patron of this program to felicitate the gathering. Sister, please.
Dignitaries, professionals, students, good morning to you all.
I am happy St. Ignatius College of Education organizes, in collaboration with our Central Library, a program on the national level for 2 days, online UGC NET program, especially for the paper second education. This is my first experience. I hope with God's grace, with the collaboration of all, it will be successful. Here I see all the participants, professionals, students, and scholars, research scholars, and NET aspirations. As we all know, as you also mentioned, this is a gateway for the future career. So here there are subject experts, you have good content, and you have a place for all the queries. So I hope all the participants will really benefit from it. So I appreciate first all the organizers and wish you all the best for all the participants. May this program be a successful and fruitful one. Thank you.
Thank you, dear sister. இவர் நூலகமும் தகவல் அறிவியல் துறையின் பயிற்சி பெற்ற தகவல் நிபுணர், நூலக நூல்களை கையாளும் செயல்பாட்டாளர், நவீன தகவல் வளங்களை கையாளும் தகவல் விஞ்ஞானி. தற்காலம் முதல் தற்காலம் வரை தேடுகின்ற யாவருக்கும் தெளிவை கொடுக்கும் இனிமை தரும் இலக்கியம், ஏற்றம் பெற்ற எண்ணங்களின் பதிவுகளை செப்பமுறை செதுக்கி சீர்படுத்தி வார்த்தெடுத்து சேர்த்து வைத்த கருவூல பெட்டகமாய் திகழ்ந்த எம் சிறப்பு விருந்தினர் திரு முத்துகிருஷ்ணன், ரிட்டையர்ட் சீனியர் லைப்ரேரியன், மாவட்ட நூலகம் திருநெல்வேலி அவர்களை வாழ்த்துரை வழங்குமாறு அன்புடன் அழைக்கின்றேன்.
1957 ஆரம்பித்து கிட்டத்தட்ட 67 வருடங்களாக இந்த பகுதியிலே ஆசிரிய கல்வியை அருமையான முறையிலே பயிற்றுவித்துக் கொண்டிருக்கின்ற இக்னேசியஸ் பிஎட் காலேஜ் நிர்வாகமும் மாவட்ட மைய நூலகமும் இணைந்து நடத்துகின்ற அது 2 நாட்களுக்கான யுஜிசி நெட் ப்ரிப்பரேட்டரி ப்ரோக்ராமுடைய
எக்ஸ்கியூஸ் மீ மேம், கரண்ட் கட் ஆயிடுச்சுன்னு நினைக்கிறேன் மேம். இந்த ஏரியா வேசர்
ஷால் வி வெயிட் ஃபார் 2 மோர் மினிட்ஸ் சென்ட்ரா?
ஷூர் மேம்,
ஷால் வி வெயிட் ஃபார் 2 மோர் மினிட்ஸ்
மேம். ஐ ஆல்சோ ஹேவ் திஸ் சார் அபௌட் தட்.
ஓகே ஓகே ஓகே.
ஹலோ, இந்த
ஷால் வி கண்டினியூ இதிலே
கலந்து கொண்டு இந்த பயிற்சி பட்டறையிலே கலந்து கொண்டிருக்கின்ற அத்தனை மாணவ மாணவிகளும் வாழ்க்கையிலே அந்த பயிற்சி முடிந்த பிறகு வாழ்க்கையிலே அந்த தேர்விலே அவர்கள் வெற்றி பெற இறையருள் வேண்டி வாழ்த்துகின்றேன். ஒரு நிகழ்ச்சியை நடத்துவது என்பது உண்மையிலேயே சாதாரண விஷயம் அல்ல. மாவட்ட மைய நூலகத்திலே பல நிகழ்வுகளை நடத்திய அனுபவத்திலே இதை நான் கூறுகின்றேன். இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியை அருமையான முறையில் ஏற்பாடு செய்திருக்கின்ற இந்த கல்லூரியினுடைய நூலகர் சகோதரி அவர்களுக்கும், இந்த கல்லூரி அவருக்கு இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியை நடத்துவதற்கு அனுமதி வழங்கிய அந்த கல்லூரியினுடைய செயலாளர் அவர்களுக்கும், நிகழ்ச்சி அருமையான முறையில் விளக்க உரை ஆற்றி அமர்ந்திருக்கின்ற கல்லூரியுடைய முதல்வர் அவர்களுக்கும், இந்த பயிற்சி வழங்க இருக்கின்ற ஆசிரியர் பெருமக்களுக்கும், பயிற்சியிலே கலந்து கொண்டிருக்கின்ற மாணவ மாணவிகளுக்கும் என்னுடைய வாழ்த்துக்களை பதிவு செய்து என்னுடைய வாழ்த்துரையை நிறைவு செய்கின்றேன். இந்த கல்லூரியிலே லட்சக்கணக்கான ஆசிரியர்கள் உண்மையிலேயே இந்த கல்லூரியிலிருந்து வெளியேறி இன்றைக்கு தமிழகம் எங்கு ஏன் இந்தியாவிலேயே இந்தியா முழுக்க அவர்கள் பணியிலே இருக்கின்றார்கள். இந்த கல்லூரியுடைய முன்னாள் மாணவன் நான். 1900 68 73 வரை அந்த இக்னேசியஸ் கான்வென்ட் என்ற அந்த கான்வென்ட் பள்ளியிலே படித்ததனால்தான் இன்றைக்கு நான் இந்த திருநெல்வேலி மாணவர்களே அடையாளம் காட்டப்படுகின்ற ஒரு மனிதராக இன்றைக்கு நான் வளர்ந்திருக்கிறேன் என்றால் அந்த தொடக்க கல்வியை நான் பெற்ற அந்த நிறுவனம் நடத்துகின்ற இந்த பயிற்சி பட்டறையிலே வாழ்த்துறை வழங்குவதற்கு உண்மையிலே நான் பெருமகிழ்ச்சி அடைகின்றேன். வழங்குவதற்கு அனுமதி அளித்த அந்த கல்லூரி நிர்வாகத்திற்கும் செயலருக்கும் நூலகருக்கும் இந்த அருமையானவர்களை இந்த நிகழ்ச்சியை தொகுத்து வழங்கி கொண்டிருக்கின்ற அந்த தொகுப்பாளினிக்கும் என்னுடைய வாழ்த்துக்களை பதிவு செய்து வாழ்த்துறையை நிறைவு செய்கின்றேன். நன்றி, வணக்கம்.
Thank you very much, sir. As we come to the close of our inauguration, I'm happy to propose the vote of thanks. I raise my heart and spirit to bow before the Almighty God. At this juncture, I thank our management for being always keen in conducting workshops, seminar, reference pushes, and webinar for the staff and students to improve the effectiveness in teaching with inspiring motivation and improvise the teaching to illuminate the young minds. Now I thank our bounteous management from the bottom of my heart. I owe heartfelt and grateful thanks to our right hand supporter and holistic picture of a dynamic personality, Reverend Sister Dr. Vasanthi Madonna, ICM, Educational Counselor, District Team, Chief Patron of this program. Thank you, dear sister. Now I request, register my profuse thanks to our respected secretary, Reverend Sister A. Jemma, ICM, Patron of this program, for giving an excellent support towards organizing this event. Thank you so much, sister. I would like to take this opportunity to extend our most sincere thanks to our beloved principal, Dr. M.R.E. Saroja, convener of this program, for her minute-to-minute guidance and support and for providing encouragement at every point of time. Thank you, dear ma'am. This event is a collaborative effort with the District Central Library, Palayamkottai. Honestly, I express my thanks to Mrs. Violet, librarian, grade 1, District Central Library, Palayamkottai, and Mr. Muthukrishnan, retired senior librarian, Palayamkottai. Thank you, ma'am and sir. I shower my heartfelt thanks and gratitude to our pragmatic visionary, beloved sister, Dr. Nirmala Devi, former principal, galaxy of intellectuals, Dr. E.C. Punita, dean of our college, Dr. Tarasita Shanti, controller of examination, Dr. Jay Sudha, vice principal, and all the teaching and non-teaching faculties. An event of this dimension cannot happen overnight and needs meticulous planning, execution, and an eye for detail. I must mention our deep sense of appreciation and thanks to our IQAC coordinator, Dr. Indra Mary Elisirvi, organizing secretary of this program. And I thank Dr. P. Jansi Rose, librarian, and Mrs. A. Lily Marie Praveena, assistant professor of our college. Thank you all. I am thankful to all the participants from various institutions who joined with us through virtual platform. I hope and request your benign cooperation throughout this program. Once again, I thank you one and all.
Thank you. Thank you, sister. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Okay, Indra, all the...
Thank you, ma'am. Shall we start the classes, ma'am? We are on the track, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. Prema, ma'am. Madam, Prema, ma'am.
Ma'am, ma'am.
The time is yours, ma'am.
Yeah. Okay, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Vanilla,
ma'am.
I must have a special mention for you, ma'am.
Thank you. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It was very fine. Sir, thank you for your timely help and also for all the efforts you have taken, sir.
Thanks to all, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Okay, ma'am. Ma'am, please proceed, ma'am.
Indra, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Jansi, ma'am.
Shall I introduce Marie Prema, ma'am?
Yes, sure. Sure, ma'am. We are waiting.
Not necessary, ma'am. Already I'm here.
I am very happy to introduce Dr. J. Marie Prema, Assistant Professor of Education, St. Ignatius College of Education, Palayamkottai. She has 14 years experience in teaching. She has guided many MEd and MPhil scholars and has edited 2 books and got Best Editor Award at 2 times. She has written chapters in 8 books. She has applied for 3 research projects and has organized several national and international seminars. She has written research articles in state, national, as well as international levels. She has attended more than 150 national and international conferences, seminars, webinars, and workshops. She was acted as chairperson, resource person, and external examiner, and also acted as school assessment committee member. She is a member in book reviewing committee also. With these words of introduction, I am happy to invite Dr. J. Mathew Prema to handle this session. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you very much, ma'am. Thank you very much for a nice introduction. Very good morning, Reverend Sister Secretary, the principal, our dignitaries from the Central Library, and the principal, our professors from various universities and colleges. I'm very happy for choosing me to share a few things about NET syllabus, especially Unit 1. Thank you very much. Okay, dear participants, welcome you all and all the best. Let us start the session. Participant, any one of you? Are you interesting? Yes. Don't think that the philosophy and the isms, personalities, and the philosophers is a heavy one. It's a very important topic. Most of the question every year, nearly 10 questions they ask from this unit. So just I explain the important points, okay? So I divide this session, only 1 hour is given to us. So I divide the session into 2. So first I explain the pattern of question, how they ask usually, okay? So in our semester exams, we have particular pattern, isn't it? So like that, don't confuse with my image because I'm using 2 devices for my convenience. Okay, so please accept inconvenience. Okay, so first I explained the pattern of question. Normally how they ask and the kind of question. First I want to explain. Now I'm going to share the screen. I have given some examples also for each type of question. To everyone? Is it visible?
Yes, ma'am. Your screen.
Can you see the screen? Okay, thank you. Thank you. So now you are seeing the unit 1, okay, the paper, under the paper 2, unit 1, I'm sharing. First, I want to give general information about the kinds of or types of questions. So every year, they follow a particular pattern. So I want to share this one first. Then you go to see the other matters in the unit 1. Okay, the word, first the root word. Usually they ask 1 or 2 questions regarding root word. So they will give one particular word. From that, they ask root word, whether it derived from Latin or Greek. So like that, the word philosophy comes from, so here you have to mention the Greek word. The answer is given here. So philos, that means love, and sophia, that means wisdom. And so is literally defined as the love of. So the root word is this, the philosophy, the term philosophy derived from the Greek word. So this kind of question usually they ask. The next type, meaning. So they have given one example, the meaning for the term Vidya or philosophy, it may be the term education. Okay, so they will give some a word, or sometimes they will give a full statement or a lengthy sentence. So from that you have to find out the particular word, find out the particular word. So here the Vidya means knowledge. So it's a repeated question also. That's why I want to highlight this example. So Vidya means knowledge. Then definition. So two types, so usually they ask, the according to Mahatma Gandhi, education is defined as. So you have to mention the definition given by Mahatma Gandhi. So particular definition they will give. So along the four choices, you have to choose the correct one. So sometimes, we move on to the next. So the philosopher, sometimes they ask philosopher, exponent, or educationist. So particular philosopher, they want to be asked. So the education is the manifestation of the perfection already in man. So this definition is given by Swami Vivekananda. So give the definition, then from the definition they will ask the particular philosopher or educationist or exponent. So this kind of question also repeatedly they are asking. Then particular year you have to mention. For example, Vishwabharati University was established in the year 1921. And before that, one more. When you study about Tagore, so the university, before the university, can you remember the term university? School. Can you remember? Shantiniketan. Shantiniketan, it was converted into Vishwabharati. Okay, so sometimes they ask year. Then duration and period. For example, the history of Buddhism spans from the which century? So to the present. So 6th century. So this kind of questions sometimes ask. Then think sentence. You have to think. So they will give one assertion, that is the concrete fact. Okay, the assertion is nothing but concrete or basic belief or fact. Where writing is, you can say, is a fact. Then another one, reason. So from the assertion and reason, you have to find out which one is correct, whether A is correct or B is correct, or A is wrong or B is wrong, both are correct or wrong. So like that you have to find out. So the four options are given below. The quotes are given below, so you have to choose the right one. Okay, so this kind of question repeatedly they are asking. So please prepare well for this kind of question. So you have to think. So to answer this question is not a simple one. So sometimes you find out the fact easily, but the reason you have to analyze properly. Okay, then only we can give the answer quickly. So it's an important one. So prepare well. Then sometimes they give they may ask quotes and slogans. So we have to find out the particular isms as they are like to be encountered in life rather than words, was the slogan of the realism. So this is the best example for this quote. Repeatedly this question also, many years, so many years they ask this kind of question. This kind of question, not this same question, teacher should emphasize on. So to answer this question, first you must understand the basic concept, please you understand, then you can answer this kind of general question. Okay, so the combination type. So the freedom, responsibility, which combination is correct? So four choices are given, not choices, four concepts are given. Then among this, which code is right? So one and two are correct, one and three are correct, one, two, and three are correct, two, three, and three are correct. So one is on. Then Steve mentioned are chronological orders. So most questions are like that. So chronological order. For example, Vedas. This question answer 3 years they are some other ones. So that we have to arrange this kind of Vedas according to the years. Okay, so which one is the percentage? So according to the century, you have to arrange. So this is a chronological order of Vedas. Sometimes they must instead of Vedas, they must another. So we expect this year also matching. So they will give two lists. Okay. So let's say that they are giving four options regarding Buddhist concepts. And the right side is the list two. So we have to match it. So codes are given below. So A, B, C, and D. Four options are given. So we have to select the best one. So extra one more option is given in the survey. Among five, we have to select four. Yeah, according to the terms given in the left side. It's a matching check. Then this is very, very important one. So critical judgment check. Okay, ready? You have to theoretically think, then you answer. So the assertion is given. Assertion already I told you is a basic fact. Okay, it's a fact. Okay, so which is related to the concept or the basic law or principle given in the above, the insertion. Go to school. Okay, whether it's a fact, you analyze it, critically think. The reason Muslim philosophy lays emphasis on the equality of sentences, not we should not say the sentences, the fact, whether it's a fact, the right fact, right or wrong, is like the right choice given under the quotes, the four choices given, so this is the right one. Okay, so most of the one I went through the previous year question papers, then finally I prepared this one. So 2 to 3 general questions social institutions, as especially the sociology, they ask this kind of questions. Especially you can expect this kind of questions from Islam. Basic principles, no, very rarely they ask like that. So the general questions usually they ask like the schools are basically social institutions.
Can you hear me?
Yes, ma'am, you are audible.
Sorry. One device is shutting down. Okay. Thank you. Sorry for inconvenience. So the general question we expect from the Islam's, okay, philosophers, their philosophy. Okay, their philosophies. And as a sociology question, so the schools are basically social institutions as they preserve and instill the values of our culture in future generation. It's the first option. Then second, please wait few seconds.
Devina ma'am, can you see the screen ma'am? Okay. Thank you ma'am, sorry. Thank you. Okay sir, the last one is the general question. Okay. So these are the different kinds of questions usually they ask. I want to share the screen. Different types of questions, already solved questions. Now we see. And before that, I want to explain about a few topics.
Yes, ma'am. Slide echo.
Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha were four ideas of life in ancient India as a Veda. Yeah, Vedic period, they taught these four important ideas. So ideas, if they ask ideas, please remember, you have to think about Dharma, Artha, Kama and Moksha. Okay, these are the ideas of ancient India. Then, math for Dharma means please nojida, dharma means righteousness, right living. Okay, dharma means righteousness. Artha means wealth. Artha means wealth. Then karma, pleasure, seeking pleasure. This is not, it's termed as kama, not karma, kama. Okay, sorry. So kama, kama means pleasure seeking. Okay, then moksha, spiritual freedom. It means spiritual freedom. So dharma, 1 year they ask a question, dharma. So under the choice they give, as already they gave, righteousness. So you have to find out. So for first, and especially I want to tell you participants, regarding Veda and Sankhya and Buddhism, then Jainism, they ask repeatedly, they have given Sanskrit language they use. So please, if you find this kind of terms like salvation, mukti, moksha, vidya, sankhya, artha, kama, so you have to see the a common word, okay, it's common term, you should be familiar, then only you can find out the right answer. So two or three they asked usually that Vedic education believed in mental discipline of its own kind. So they are giving more importance to mental discipline. Okay, so mukti or emancipation has been the highest end of life. So they are focusing, the highest one is the mukti or emancipation. They are focusing the highest value issue is the important one for their life. Then the realization of the life is called salvation. This question also already asked in previous question, I find out. So realization of the self is called salvation. Then Gurukulas were the centers of education in Vedic period. You know very well, isn't it? Gurukula is the educational center. Okay, educational center in Vedic period. Then the students remained with the guru for 12 years. When they were getting education, they must be along with the guru maximum of 12 years in the Vedic period. Okay, maximum of 12 years. So this year also, one question I found out. So next, in Vedic period, Upanayana is a ceremony. Okay, Upanayana is a kind of ceremony, was performed at the age of 8. At the age of 8, they celebrated a grand ceremony. Okay, is Upanayana. Upanayana, please remember that. The most important ways for the realization of moksha are the important ways how we attain moksha. That is given here, selfless action. Okay, selfless action and dhyana. These two ways are mentioned to attain moksha. Okay, right? Vedanta. Then actions are followed by result in the law of karma. Based on the karma, we can attain moksha. Yeah. Otherwise, we cannot reach. So, and before that, the law of karma, you understand the law of karma, we must understand ourselves. This is given here, okay, the fantastic philosophy. So the actions are followed by the result in the law of karma. According to our own karma, in future life, our next life, okay, so our life will be decided based on our own karma vinay, no? Okay, so the period of education for Brahmins were 48 years. The period of education, please note it down. The period of education for Brahmins. Why we mentioned here Brahmins? Because they are going to be a teacher. Okay, so for teaching the Brahmins how to learn for 48 years. Don't be confused. Okay, so 48 years they have to get education for preaching. So the Brahmins were allowed, not other peoples were not allowed in those days. So here, that's why we mentioned Brahmins. Okay, so Brahmins, the period of education for Brahmins, 48 years maximum. Then they can preach, okay, or teach. Then, when there were large classes, the method followed was monitorial. So monitorial method, in those days also they followed monitorial method. Okay, then the theory of rebirth is a necessary corollary of the law of karma. So the theory of rebirth is based on karma. Okay, so this question also asked one year that the word karma pasana, the word karma pasana means work of worship. Work of worship. The word karma pasana, the word karma pasana means work of worship. Okay, then the religion occupied a prominent place in the Vedic period. Only the religion, they were given importance. Okay, they were placed in a high position in the society because they only teach and preach. Okay, so something there. Most of the time they were worshipped by the common people. So religion occupied a prominent place in the Vedic period. Then in Vedic period, Indian literature is the vehicle of religion. So for the religious, only the vehicle is Indian literature. Okay, Indian literature. Then the Vedic literature saw mainly the main basis for Vedic education. Okay, the Vedic literatures are mainly it's a basis for Vedic education. So Vedic education so completely comprising of Vedic literatures. Then the literal meaning of Vedas is what? Everybody know, okay? Knowledge. Okay, the literal meaning of Vedas is knowledge. Last year also this question asked. Yeah, this question was asked. Then the word Veda derived from the root word Vid. Okay, Vid or Vidya. Sometimes some book we can find the word with instead of with vidya also they give. So the means to know. Okay, the word Veda derived from the root word Vid. Vid is a Greek word, the root of Greek language, that means to know. Then the Rig Veda, Acharya Guru is called Agni Pracheta. Okay, in Rig Veda, Acharya Guru is called what? Agni Pracheta. Why I mentioned this terms means these questions were already asked in previous question. That's why I included these kind of terms. Okay, so which means specially learned. Acharya Guru, sometimes usually use this term, isn't it? So in Rig Veda, the Acharya Guru is called Agni Pracheta. That means specially learned. Okay, specially learned. Then the relationship of Guru and Shishya, just like a father and son. The relationship was like that in those days, in Vedic period. Guru and Shishya, they had a strong relation, okay? The strong relationship between them, like father and son, okay? So next, in Vedic period, next, a few things I want to share about you. Buddhism. Okay, next you move on to Buddhism. So in Buddhism, the Buddhist education, much emphasis was laid on the physical, mental, and psychological. So that means what? All-round development. They are given. I give more important to all-round development, overall development they focus. So physical, mental, and psychological. Okay, the total period of education in the Buddhist system was 22 years. In Veda, it is different. Okay, in Veda, it is different. But in Buddhist period, totally 22 years of education. Okay, the total period of education, 22 years. This question also already asked. Then education started with a ceremony called in Vedic period what? Remember? Can you remember in Vedic period? Opening ceremony at the age of 8? Tell me that term.
Upanayana.
Yes, very good. I appreciate you, Upanayana, isn't it? As I'm very happy that you are all listening. Thank you so much. Just I'm sharing an important point. It's a vast area. Unit 1 is a big unit. But most of the questions around these questions, what I am telling now. So I list out all the questions and I'm sharing. Okay. So I cannot explain detailed manner. Okay. So if I commit any mistake, please forgive me. Very big genius are attending the session. No, very well. So if I commit any mistake, please. Okay. So thank you very much. So in Papaja, in Buddhist education, the opening ceremony is the Papaja. It's the first ceremony, okay, to attain education. Then students were admitted. Please understand, students were admitted in the primary level of education, at the age of 6. Okay. Then during the Buddhist period, the education had two levels. The education was given in under two levels. The first one is primary level and the second one higher level. There are two levels. So what are the questions I am discussing? Please, all the participants, this all the questions were asked in previous year. So please note it down. Okay, please note it down. The answer at least. Okay. So during the Buddhist period, education had two levels. It was given under two levels, primary level and a higher level. Okay. But in primary level, three R were given important. Only they taught three R. Three R what? Three R? Yes, reading, writing, and arithmetic. Okay, so these were given important in primary level. This is the whole education in primary level. Three R only. Okay, three R, three capital R. Then, see, in primary level, they were given important to three R. Buddhist universities, in universities, they offered monastic and general education. So, in higher level also, they were given education under two. Okay, so divide education into two. So under two types of, two types. One is monastic, another one general education. So two types of education were given in the university level or higher level. What are they? Monastic and general education. Okay, so the total period of Papaja was 12 years. Please don't confuse with the year of education. At the year of 6, they entered the education. Okay, they entered Gurukulam for getting education at the age of 6 in a Buddhist period. Then the total years for getting education for normal people, after getting education, they come back to, okay, they come back to home. So come back home. So this year is total year 12 years. Please understand. Okay, so the Buddhist, the total period of Papaja was 12 years. After 12 years, they go back home. Okay, then the total period of Apsampada, UP, sorry, Apsampada, the term Apsampada was 10 years. So a child of 8 years was at the age of 6, okay. At the age of 8 years, the child was admitted to mat or vihara. Vihara or mat. So M-A-T-H, mat. Okay. So this, to get education under this level, mat or vihara at the age of 8. Okay. So just you think, the age of 6, they started education, isn't it? But here they are given at the age of 8, they entered math or vigaras. In between, what about the 2 years? What did they do? Can you imagine? Anybody? Yes, professors? Any participants? Do you have any idea? Yes, 2 years is missing here. That these 2 years, the guru examined the, Shishya, okay? Examined the Shishya, whether he or she is eligible, whether he is here, is eligible to get education, okay? So one book I found, the incident, what happened in Vedic education, now how we are getting education under AC room. That's why we have this kind of quality present scenario. We cannot compare in Vedic education how the education was, the quality was. Okay, so I give an example that these 2 days, 2 years, the guru examined the learner, the gurushishya, the student, whether he is or she is eligible to get education. What actually did means, one example I read in the book, usually they give a bitter gun, but the students, if he or she was interested, he is not able to realize the taste of bitter gun. If he realize, she is not eligible. Please imagine when send our children to school, if whether they realize the bitter gun, anyone at least, everybody realize. So whether we are eligible, grown children, so we cannot imagine so many things you have to study about Vedic period and Buddhist period. So in Buddhist education, so very, very strict. Okay, so bitter gourd, this story, it happened actually in Vedic period, okay? Not in Buddhist period, it's Vedic period. So very strict, very strict. The education system is very rigid and strict. But at the same time, they have given, freedom. The students were given freedom also, okay? But well disciplined. So the 2 years, please don't be confused. At the age of 6, they were admitted in the Gurukulam, okay? The Gurukulam or the Buddhist education was started, but 2 years is a preliminary years for getting education. So after 2 years, at the age of eight, they were admitted the level math, okay? Admitted to math or Vikara, okay? This is about Buddhism. Then, this page. Then Jainism. I want to share a few things. Think about Jainism. So Jainism believes reality to be many-sided. What different dimensions they focus? Okay, different, the multi-dimensional focusing. So the Jainism believes the reality to be many-sided in our life. So multi-faceted. So the vital principle of Jainism is ahimsa. Okay, the vital principle of Jainism is what? Ahimsa. Okay, ahimsa is the vital principle of Jainism. The one term is given in Jainism. So 1 year the question was asked. Sajivan, S-A-J-J. I-V-A-N, Sojivan means pure life, okay? Sojivan means pure life. Okay, this question was asked already. Then, Jain philosophy have mentioned about 72 arts or industries, okay? 72 arts. They have mentioned 72 arts or industries. The one who influences the conduct of the pupil is called Acharya. Who is Acharya? One who influences the conduct of the pupil. Pupil, that means students, not pupil. So pupil or student or learner is called Acharya. Okay, the punishments for disciplining the student should be repentance mode. It was given in a repentance mode. Then women education was not favored by was. Yeah. The women education was not much supported. Okay, in Jainism. Then the Jainism accepts the existence of immortal souls. The Jainism also accept the existence of immortal soul. Okay, so Nirvana is attained through three jewels. According to Jainism, Nirvana, the state of Nirvana is attained through three jewels. They mention the term jewels, that is called Triratna. Okay, the term Triratna. So the Jainism rejects the idea of creation of the world. The Jainism rejects the creation of the world. Then Jainism says material world is real. What we have, the concrete thing, it believes. Okay, the Jainism believes on concrete, the material world. Then Islam, I want to share one or two questions already asked in previous question paper. Among Muslim rulers, Akbar did commendable works in the field of education. They mentioned Akbar. Okay, so Akbar is a remarkable personality in Islam. Yeah, Muslim period. Then during Muslim period, education was organized in maktabs and madarsas. Madrasa, some book it is given like madrasa, madarsas, okay, madarsas, maktabs and madarsas. These were the educational educational centers. In Muslim period, then primary education was given in maktabs. So primary education is given in maktabs. Then higher education was given in madarsas. Madarsas, the maktabs for primary education, madarsas were given higher education. Okay, so higher education was given in madarsas. Then in maktabs, children were given the tenets of Quran and the Kriyas. That's all. So in maktabs, they taught only Quran and Kriyas. Okay, then religious and regular subjects, so common subjects, general subjects, religious and general subjects taught in madarsas. So in madarsas, they taught general science, it may be science or civic or astrology. So general studies and religious, they were taught in madarsas. Okay, then we move on to isms. Then regarding Buddhism, they follow noble truths. Regarding Buddhism, they follow noble truths. I list out the truth. Sometimes they ask chronological order also. Okay, so there is suffering is the first one. There is suffering, then there is a cause of suffering. There is suffering, then there must be a cause for suffering. Then third one, there is cessation of suffering. Third one, there is cessation of suffering. And fourth one, there is a way leading to cessation of suffering. That is Nirvana. Okay, Nirvana. So these four were given as a noble truth of in a Buddhist period, noble truth. Then eightfold path to attain Nirvana. How to attain Nirvana? They highlighted eight path. Just I mentioned right faith, then right resolve, right faith, second one right resolve, then right speech, right action, right living, right effort, then right thought and right concentration. If you have these gates, definitely we can attain Nirvana. Okay, so according to Buddhism, when you follow these eight, definitely we can attain Nirvana. Okay, so some implications are given here, so you are able to write, no problem. Then regarding Jainism, regarding Jainism, the important aim of life is liberation. This question is asked. This question was already asked, so I want to recall. Okay, so the main aim of life, according to Jain system of education or Jainism, is liberation. Okay, then non-violence. Another one, non-violence. Then efforts and good conduct, and right speech. Right speech. Liberation, right speech. Great effort is a hard work. Okay, hard work, then right conduct, discipline. Okay, right conduct. Then five principles, they highlighted five principles in Jainism. Non-violence is the first one, non-violence, and second one, truth, then non-stealing, then non-stealing, not only the object, stealing of objects. Here we should think about now you are stealing others' cognitive property, isn't it? When you write the journal or when you write any article, without their permission, you just not borrow, just we steal the content from others, simply. So this is also not a right. It comes under stealing. Okay, so non-stealing. The brahmacharya life, you have to lead brahmacharya life. Then giving away of others' wealth, all kinds of wealth. So giving away of others' wealth. Okay, so non-violence, truth, non-stealing, then brahmacharya life, brahmacharya, then giving away of others' wealth. So these were the basic principle in Jainism. Then the methodology and teaching and the curriculum, these are all we can write. Okay. There are they mentioned different kinds of knowledge. Jainism, they mentioned different important kinds of knowledge is perception, inference, and testimony. This question also, I saw in the previous question, so I wrote it. Okay, so perception, kinds of knowledge according to Jainism. Perception is the first one, then inference, and ma'am, third one, testimony. Yes?
Ma'am, Prema ma'am, sorry for the disturbance. Ma'am, your screen is not visible, ma'am. ஒரு டிவைஸ் மட்டும் கனெக்ட்ல இருக்கு.
ஓகே மேம், ப்ளீஸ் வெயிட். ஓகே ஓகே பார்ட்டிசிபன்ட்ஸ், நவ ஐ அம் கோயிங் டு ஷேர் தி ஸ்கிரீன் அண்ட் வி கேன் see ஒன் பை ஒன் தி வேர்ல்ட் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ். ஓகே, தி சால்வ்ட் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் நவ வி see. பிரவீனா மேம், தேங்க் யூ. I think now it is visible. Yes.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Pravina, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Okay. Now it's clear. Okay. So, dear participants, now we see the previous questions. So, answer is given. So, repeatedly, they ask the question epistemology. Please. You know, you should know the meaning for epistemology, metaphysics, and axiology. Okay, these three terms is repeatedly asking, because these three terms are basic for philosophy. So epistemology, metaphysics, and axiology, especially epistemology, 4 or 5 years they ask the question. Okay, so please understand the main, the basic meaning for epistemology. So the meaning for epistemology, branch of philosophy which deals with the theory of what? Knowledge. Okay, the theory of knowledge is called what? Epistemology. Then second question, already I told you, this kind of question repeatedly they ask. Every year they ask this kind of question. There are two statements given. The first one is assertion and the second one is reason. You see, read these two and find out the answer. So philosophy helps in determining the aims of education. Okay, philosophy helps in determining the aims of education is a basic concept, whether it's true or false. You should think over it. Then, second, reason. Education depends mostly on philosophy. You know what is education and what is philosophy? You just compare it and see the reason, whether it's right or wrong. Then the answer is A. Both A and B are true. Yes, philosophy helps in determining aims of education. So when you frame the aims of education, think about the aims of education, we must know the complete, the template of philosophy. Without philosophy, you cannot give the aim of education, right? So it's a fact, it's a general fact. So this statement is right. Then another one, reason is education depends mostly on philosophy. To my knowledge, not mostly, it's completely depend on philosophy. The whole life, whatever we have in our societies, everything. Maybe the philosophy, concept, or laws, or principle, whatever may be, everything comes under philosophy. The philosophy is a basic concept. Okay, the education is one part of philosophy. Please understand, participants. So, education depends mostly on philosophy. It's the 100% the right reason. So, A and R. That means not A and R. The code A is correct. So, A, R, and R. That means assertion and reason both are right. True. Okay. Now, next to the third one. Now, third question. Yeah, the things as they are. The things as they are and as they are likely to be encountered in life rather than words. What philosophy? In which philosophy it comes? Yes, it comes under? B. Realism. Okay, realism. Okay, realism. So, next question. An existentialistic teacher should emphasize a general question. First you understand the concept, existentialism, then you are able to answer. So it's a general question. So the existentialistic teacher should emphasize on freedom, responsibility, subjective feelings, then cooperative living. Which one is hard? You find us already went through. The C is correct. Okay, first, second, and third statements are correct. So, right. Next, who advocated the creation of a classless society? It comes under sociology. Who advocated? It's a personality or some particular philosopher. They ask also, who advocated the creation of a classless society? Can you imagine? Okay, Karl Marx. Okay, Karl Marx, right answer. And next question. The Vedas teach us that, what actually it teaches? Creation is without beginning. Then creation is without an end. There is no beginning, there is no ending. So according to Veda, which statement is correct? Creation is without beginning and without an end. Creation has a definite beginning and also an end. Which one is correct? Yes. The C is correct. Creation is without beginning and without end. There is no starting point then and end point in our life. So the creation is without beginning and without an end. So this is also a general question. Next, will Tagorean education system, according to Tagore philosophy, the child learns better by which method is best according to Tagore philosophy? Which statement is right here? Debates and discussion, reading, writing and speaking, dance, drama and music. Yeah, you know one thing, Tagore is an international thinker, okay? He supported all the philosophies, and Western philosophy, Western literature, everything we must learn. So she supported international level of educational system. So please, that is her problem, okay? The international personality, like that you keep in your mind. So it is easy for giving answer. So data, I mean, debates, discussion, reading, writing, and speaking, then dance, drama, and music, and traveling, and the interacting with the nature, which is the right. These right statement, 1, 3, and 4. 1, 3, and 4, okay? Next, okay, the question is, the same question repeated, that means that it was asked the next year also, next year question also. So I collected this question in the previous examination question bank, okay? So it will be easy, and most of the question definitely repeat. So you can expect this question. Okay, then one more question is given here. Yes, it's a, Ascension, philosophy helps in the, it's the same question, same question. It's it. So some question will ask related to our constitution, okay? Indian constitution, democracy, and our, what you call, human rights. Okay, so this kind of question also we can expect. So please go through the recent law, recent articles added in our constitution. So it will be helpful for your examination. Okay, the right to free and compulsory education. Free and compulsory education for children between the age group of 6 to 14 has been inserted in Indian constitution as which article? 21A. Okay, it is supported by 21A, the article 21A. Then, who advocated the logical analysis of language for getting the true meaning? True meaning is A.J. Iyer. Okay, A.J. Iyer. So, is a kind of a, they ask a philosopher, a psychologist. Next, one more question from sociology. Sociology of education is sociology. Then what is sociology? This question also repeatedly asking. So sociology of education is a branch of anthropology, study of the society, and analysis of sociological processes involved in the institution of education. Please understand sociology is something different, sociology of education, okay? So science which studies primitive society. This is the right answer. The C is right. An analysis of sociological processes involved in the institution of education is the right answer. The sociology of education. Then, the schools are basically social institutions. As what actually does. Okay. Why we call it a school is a is considered as a social institution. That is what you're asking here. So, they preserve and instill the values of our culture in future generations. Then they suggest ways and means for social progress. Then they just suggest solution to social problems. They are established by the society. Which one is right? So you analyze the four statement, four statements, then you find out the answer. So see, the first one is the right answer. They preserve and instill, okay, inculcate the values of our culture in future generation. This is the basic and vital role of school. Okay, that's why we call it as a social institution. Okay, next. It is not, one more thing I want to tell you, some negative statements also, negative question also given. One question definitely you can expect. So please, when we read the statement, sometimes we skip the term, the negative term, not. Sometimes we forget to note the term, not. So you take the sentence in a positive way, so there is a chance to give up on, wrong answer. So please aware. When you read the question, please be careful. some one or two questions may ask a negative term will be given in the question. So which is not a criterion used consistently for placing people in a particular social class. Okay, when you place the people in a society under that, I mean class wise, which is not a criteria. This is a question. Race, religion, knowledge, wealth, which is not considered much knowledge. Okay, knowledge. Based on the knowledge, we are not placing the people in a different classes in a society. Okay. So knowledge is a right answer. Next. Next question. So this is also a general question. So we should, you must clear about the race, class, tribe, family, okay, then classes. So then only you can answer for this question. Beginning with family as the lowest unit, which of the following constitutes the correctly sequenced hierarchy of social group? Which the hierarchical order is given here. Which order is correct? From the yes, it's already given family. Family is the lowest unit. Okay, from the family, if you order these terms, which order is correct? So B is correct. Family, then class. Okay, then tribe, race, and nation. So it's a general question. So if you understand the concept, you are able to answer correctly. Okay. Next, use of science and technology. So important question. Okay. Use of science and technology in replacing existing social practices is termed as what? Modernization. So modernization. Next. The process of imbibing one's own culture in one's personality is termed as enculturation. So please you read the meaning for enculturation, acculturation, socialization, sanitization, easily find out. Socialization also you easily find it, but you must know the enculturation and acculturation. Okay, acculturation. So you must clear about it. Then critically judge the following. One more thing I want to share. Yes, critically judge the following. So you have to think critically, then only you can give correct answer. Assertion: my religion is the best religion. My religion is the best religion. Whether the assertion must be a general fact, okay? General fact, whether it is a fact. So the given statement is right or wrong. The reason is the democratic philosophy allows me to think and live with freedom. We discuss with others, okay? I collect so many reasons, this kind of questions from the net. And you find out the answer. Okay, the answer is given here. The D is correct. Yes, only R is true. That means the reason is true. How do we say my religion is the best religion? Yes, we cannot say. It's not a general concept. Okay, so like that you have to find it. Definitely this kind of question asked. Which of the following chains represents the change processes underlying educational system of free India? Psychological change, social change, political change, and educational change. Okay, which? Again, I read the question. Which of the following change represent the change processes underlying educational system of free India? B is correct. B is correct, which is the order. Political change. If anything change in the political structure, definitely it will affect the social structure. Then it passes on to the people minds, psychological. Yes, then educational change according to the need of the learners or need of the, students or psychological need, then you coin the goals and aims of education. Isn't it? So this is the right right change, but we have to discuss. Okay, so this given in the right, but we have to discuss. Okay, next, the son of, this is a very important general question. And before that, you must clear about the social change. What is social change? What is social mobility? Just to read out some examples. Otherwise, we cannot give the answer for this kind of question. Okay, social cohesion, then social stratification. So, the son of a rickshaw puller struggles and becomes an engineer. Okay, the son of a rickshaw puller struggles and becomes an engineer. This is an example of social change, social stratification, social mobility, or social cohesion. Social mobility.
Ma'am, yes? Wait. Sorry for the interruption. Time exits.
Okay, mom. What should I do? Okay, thank you. Thank you, Praveena, ma'am. Thank you. Dear participant, thank you very much. Very little part only I shared with you. And okay, but I am very happy for sharing few things about particular topics. If time provides, we will discuss in later. Okay.
Thank you so much. Sorry, ma'am.
Thank you, Prema, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Prema, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am.
Thank you for your wonderful presentation.
Not wonderful, just what I taken few notes only. And thank you, ma'am. Thank you, Rose, ma'am. And
thank you, ma'am.
Organizers. And I
thank you.
Share my gratitude to our management. Thank you very much, and thank you very much for patient attend. Patiently are attending my session. Yes, I hope you are all attending sincerely. So thank you very much, all the participants. Thank you so much.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you.
Dear participants, next session will start sharp at 11:15 a.m. Thank you.
Participants, you could stay online, otherwise have some break and come, okay? You could stay at 11:15, sharply at 11:15, the next session will start. Ma'am, Dear participants, the next session will start at 11:15. That is after 6 minutes, sharply after 6 minutes. Good morning, sir.
Sir, good morning. Velmurugan, sir.
Good morning, madam. Good morning.
Good morning.
Velmurugan, sir. Good morning, sir.
Good morning, madam. Good morning.
Shall we start, sir?
Okay, ma'am. Okay. We can start.
I am very happy to welcome our resource person, Dr. P. Velmurugan, Associate Professor, Onyesomy College of Education, Muttur. He has 15 years of teaching experience and research experience in the field of education. He has acted as a resource person and chairperson in various seminars and conferences. He has organized 18 programs at national, international, and regional level. He has run more than 100 seminars, conferences, workshops, etc. He has published 42 articles, 3 chapters, reviewed 257 articles in various reputed journals. He has presented 38 papers at the national and international seminars. He has written 3 books, namely Teaching of History, History in Education, and Handbook on Education. He has received Lifetime Achievement Award, Best Student Award, Best Faculty Award, Gold Medal, Honorary Doctorate. He is a life member of various organizations such as Radhakrishnan Welfare Association, Kanyakumari Academy of Arts and Science, IMRF Voice of Teachers. He has organized NET and TET coaching classes that is a resource person at various institutions. Such kind of eminent personalities come over here. On behalf of the management of St. Ignatius College of Education, the District Library, Palayakottai, and my own behalf, I extend a warm welcome, dear sir.
Thank you, ma'am. Thank you, madam.
Now I present this session to Dr. Velmurugan. Thank you, sir. Over to you.
Okay, welcome, ma'am. Welcome. Okay, first of all, I would like to thank the management of Ignatius College of Education and the coordinators of the NET preparatory program and the district library Palayakottai and the faculty members of Ignatius College of Education. I extend a warm an opportunity to share something this platform related to NET preparatory program. Ma'am, just a minute. PPT is going to share. Okay. Ma'am, is it visible? Madam?
Yes, sir, it's visible, sir.
Okay. Okay, so today the second session we have to start the unit 2 based upon the history, politics and economics of education. Here there is 4 aspects are there. One is committees and commissions related to education. Then second one is policies and education. Then third one is economics of education. Then fourth aspect is politics and education. So already we are know about the committees and the commissions of education. Then the policies and education also. Then economics of education. We are know a little bit know about the economics of education and politics of politics and education. So I think we will discuss one by one based upon the theories and also the UGC question patterns also discussed. Then again we will continue the aspects one by one. Okay, so the first we will start the committees and commissions. In our syllabus they provide the committees and commissions, our secondary education commission, Kothari Education Commission, National Policy on Education, National Commission on Teachers, the National Curriculum Framework, National Knowledge Commission, the Neshbal Committee Report, National Curriculum Framework for Teacher Education, and Justice Verma Committee Report. These commissions and committee reports are included in your syllabus. Already we have known about these commissions in B.Ed and M.Ed level also. I think a little bit knowledge about these commissions to discuss with you. Then again, we skip the next chapter because the time limit is very, the time limitation is very short, so that we can discuss a little bit knowledge about the committees and commissions. Then first committees and commissions for secondary education commission. We all know about the Second Education Commission. It was the chairperson of the Second Education Commission is Lakshmana Swami Mudaliar. Then the commission was recommended and appointed by the Central Advisory Board of Education in 1949. Then also the commission, the Second Education Commission, the report contains 15 chapters and 10 appendices. Then the aim of the Second Education Commission is educational needs of democratic India, then developing democratic citizenship, then improvement of vocational efficiency, then development of personality and education for leadership. These are all the aims of secondary education. Then the recommendation based upon the Second Education Mudaliar Commission recommendation, they provide a few important recommendations also, that is technical and vocational education, the need for diversification of courses should be included, and multilateral and multi-purpose schools established, then agriculture education secondary schools, and basic principles of curriculum construction. These are the most important recommendations provided by the Secondary Education Commission. You know, it's okay.
Yes, you are presenting, sir. Yeah.
Am I sitting visible?
It's visible, sir, but it is not moving. Only first slide is visible. Now it's okay.
Oh. Okay, okay, ma'am. Okay.
Yeah, thank you, sir. Thank you so much.
Okay, ma'am. Okay. So these are all the major recommendations of Mudaliar Commission. The one is diversification of courses, then multilateral and multi-purpose schools, then agricultural education. Then the next commission is called Kothari Commission. It was established in 1964. It is the sixth commission in the history of education, Commission India. Then also the entitle of the commission name is Education and National Development. Here it is 12, set up 12 task forces and 7 working groups are there. These people, they interviewed 9,000 men and women in different fields. They gathered information from 9,000 men and women in the field of education and also some other fields, and write a report and submit to the Government of India. Then begin to start on 2nd October 1964 and submitted on 29 June 1966. The chairman of the Kothari Commission is Dr. Professor D.S. Kothari. It consists of 16 members also. The major recommendation of the Kothari Commission is only the establishment of a common school system, then book bank facilities, then residential facilities should be established, 10 years of schooling of general education, then provision of day study centers, then education for backward classes, then freedom to schools of experimental curricula, then establishing school complexes, and also neighborhood schools and Indian Education Service, then also vocational, technical, and engineering education also. These recommendations are provided by the Kothari Commission. We will discuss in the question later. We will discuss the questions. Then only we can understand what are the questions UGC asked. Then the next one is National Policy on Education. So it was introduced by Mr. Rajiv Gandhi on January 1985. It was otherwise called Challenge of Education, a Policy Perspective. It is considered as the Magna Carta of education also. So the university grand commission, they will ask the questions based upon these titles, Challenges of Education, a Policy Perspectives, and the Magna Carta of education. So it contains 12 parts and 157 paragraphs. The recommendations of the National Policy on Education 1986, education for women's equality, then education of scheduled caste and scheduled tribes and also minorities, then handicapped, other backward class sections also, broad education, then adult education, given importance to adult education, then opening of open university and distance learning, then establishment of rural universities, dealing in courses from jobs, then introducing operational blackboard, then Navodaya Vidyalaya, establishment of Navodaya Vidyalayas, then introduction of educational technology. So these are all the major aspects recommended by the National Policy on Education 1986. Then the next commission, the program of action. So it is also 1986. It is based upon the National Education Policy 1986. So here the Central Advisory Board of Education discussed the meeting and implemented the program of action 1986. It was presented in the Parliament in 8th August 1986, and it was approved by the Lok Sabha and the Rajya Sabha in 22nd and 23rd August 1986. The major content of the program of action is where the early childhood care and education, then elementary education, non-formal education, and operational Blackboard, and also some secondary education and Navodaya Vidyalaya, then vocational of education, technical and management education, education for SCST and other communities, other backward communities, then give importance to youth and sports, language development, cultural perspectives, media and educational technology. These are all aspects or events proposed by the program of action. The discussion in the meeting of Central Advisory Board of Education, and they have submitted the report to the government for implementation of the actions. Then the based upon the program of action, revised national education policy was prepared in 1992. It was revised in both houses of parliament in 7th May 1992 by the Honorable Minister Arjun Singh. He introduced the, he presented the revised national education policy in parliament. The major important, there is two thing, major things are changed or revised in the national education policy. That is, one is the organization of self-employment or the self-employment oriented programs and the need interest of vocational and skill trainings. These are the two things are added or revised in the national education policy and also modified. Here there is 157 paras are there in the national in the policy, revised national policy on education. Here 31 paras were modified and rearranged and revised the and implemented the revised national education policy on 1992. The next commission based upon the National Commission on Teacher Education. It is purely based on teacher education. It was set up in 1983 for the four-year integrated course, teacher training courses included after the senior secondary education. We have completed 4 years training courses and also preferably 5-year course leading to graduation and the trainings recommended by this National Commission on Teacher Education. And also for elementary teachers, it is desirable to have 2-year training courses after the completion of secondary education, that means 12th standard. Then, and also the major important points, the commission was suggested that the practice teaching should be replaced by the word, I think, internship. So the word practice teaching was replaced and they coined the name internship in teacher education programs. So this commission is based upon fully the program based on teacher education. Then the next commission, that is National Curriculum Framework. There is not a commission, but it's a National Curriculum Framework. So the NCERT, National Council for Educational Research and Training, NCERT, published this National Curriculum Framework. So I think the, in before took three NCF National Curriculum Framework was published. That is one in 1975, then 1988, then again 2000, then 2005. So it was published by NCERT. The chairman of this NCF National Curriculum Framework was Professor Yeshwar. So this framework consists of five divisions, and perspectives of the connecting knowledge of knowledge to life. Learning shifts away from rote methods, enriching curricula beyond the textbooks, then making examination more flexible. These are all the aspects included in the National Curriculum Framework. The curriculum areas, that's the language, mathematics, science, social science, computers, peace, health and physical education, work education. These are all aspects are included in the curriculum area. Then these are suggested and also clearly mentioned and teacher people raise it. That means so one is to 30. There is your the school and the school that people the teacher ratio is considered who what 1:30. Then this is systematic reform they have given for learners the education based upon the learner center and it is flexible, then learner autonomy, they were given learner autonomy, facilitate the teachers act as if facilitator, then develop multidisciplinary curriculum. So these all the events are included in the national curriculum framework 2005. Then the next commission based upon
sir, excuse me, sir. Your voice is breaking. You're not audible. Sir? Yeah, net error pull up. Sir, your voice kick away, ma'am. Okay, let us wait for 2 minutes, okay? Sir, join panavanga. We just wait for 2 minutes. Ma'am, wait pano. Sir, join panavanga.
Oh, okay, sir. Okay. Okay, ma'am.
Ma'am, could you make a call, ma'am? Sir, to help me, ma'am. Ma'am? Jansi, ma'am?
I'm calling to the sir.
Okay. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, yes, ma'am.
Ma'am? Veena, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, tell me.
Sir will join now. Sir will join.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Participants, sir will come within 5 minutes. Wait, please.
ma'am, sorry, what shall we do? Sir, pesinaangala ma'am?
Ma'am?
Sir, pesinaangala ma'am?
Ma'am, pesinaangala, ஒரு 5 நிமிஷத்துல வரேன் நான் லேப்டாப்ல கனெக்ஷன் வரேன்
ஓகே 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 மேம் ஓகே மேம்
ரொம்ப மழை பெய்யுது அதனால ரொம்ப லேட்டா மேம்
ஓ சரி 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 மேம் சார் கனெக்ட் ஆயிட்டாங்கன்னு நினைக்கிறேன்
ஐ திங்க் ஓகே சார்
மேம் அது வரைக்கும் ஷால் ஐ பிரசன்ட் சம் ப்ரீவியஸ் இயர் க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ்
ஓகே மேம் ஓகே 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 ஓகே
ஓகே எஸ் மேம் யா டியர் பார்ட்டிசிபென்ட்ஸ் ஐ அம் பிரசன்டிங் எ ப்ரீவியஸ் இயர் க்வெஸ்சன் ஐ திங்க் இட் இஸ் யூஸ்ஃபுல் ஃபார் யூ ஓகே ட்ரை டு ஃபைண்ட் த ஆன்சர் ஃபார் ஆல் த க்வெஸ்சன்ஸ் ஓகே யா ஹியர் இஸ் அ ப்ரீவியஸ் இயர் க்வெஸ்சன் Could you see? Participants?
Yes, ma'am.
Yeah. Here is a previous question. The first thing, the branch of philosophy. Okay. Yeah. Try to find the answer for the first question. Anyone?
D answer
epistemology
knowledge
yeah what is that
metaphysics
epistemology
metaphysics
metaphysics
epistemology
yes ma'am
no
metaphysics yeah reality try okay again Yeah, the book written by Plato.
The Republic.
The Republic, yeah.
The Republic.
Republic.
The Republic.
Yeah, Republic, yeah.
Hi, my yes.
Existentialism my. Believes more than that. This is correct for the third question.
Existence than in essence.
Yeah. Is it? Any other answer?
Existence and essence.
Existence and essence. Okay. Very quick. Okay, again. Then democracy, fourth one. Yeah. Fourth one. Could you find?
Option A,
integrity. Yeah. Yeah. Danti ma'am, sir, can you take the same phone? Okay, ma'am.
Okay, okay, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Fifth one.
Hello.
Yes, you could present now, sir. Okay, just a minute. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes, ma'am, is it visible?
Yes, sir, visible.
Hello?
Yeah.
Okay, madam. So I have given a lot, a few questions later to the first content of commissions and committees of education. These questions are also asked by the University Grant Commission. The first one is the National Knowledge Commission was established in which year? Anybody want to say the answer? 2005. The National Knowledge Commission was established in the year. Okay, then the next question, National Commission for Teachers to Deal with Issues Related to Teachers at School Level was set up by Government of India in the year. In 1984, the National Commission for Teacher Education was established. Then the third one, according to NCF, NCF means National Curriculum Framework 2005, the role of a teacher has to be asked the role in the NCF 2005 on the very good, facilitative. Then the fourth, a review of NPE, National Policy on Education 1986, program of action was done by?
Nishpal Committee.
Eshwal Committee.
Eshwal Committee.
No.
Ramamurthy Committee.
Yes, very good. Ramamurthy Committee. Two members were appointed. One is among the Ramamurthy Committee. So he is the number three is the answer. Ramamurthy Committee. Done by the Review of National Policy on Education 1986. Then the fifth question, the recommendation to reduce the burden of school bags was given by in the commission on the குழந்தைகளுக்கு வந்து சுமையை குறைக்கணும் அப்படினு சொல்லி recommend பண்ணாங்க. Which commission?
Eshwal Committee.
Eshwal Committee. Yes, very good. Eshwal Committee. Then the next one, establishment of DIETS. DIET means District Institute of Educational Training. Was a result of one of the recommendations by?
Nishpal Committee.
எந்த கமிஷன் வந்து டைட் வந்து நிறுவனம் அப்படின்னு சொல்லி ரெக்கமெண்ட் பண்ணாங்க
செகண்டரி எஜுகேஷன் கமிஷன்
செகண்டரி எஜுகேஷன் கமிட்டி
செகண்டரி எஜுகேஷன் கமிஷன் 1953
யூனிவர்சிட்டி
எஜுகேஷன் கமிஷன்
யூனிவர்சிட்டி எஜுகேஷன் கமிஷன் No, National Policy on Education, okay? National Policy on Education, 1986, recommended to establish the DIET, okay? So, one of the five components of the scheme was the establishment of DIET also. So, National Policy on Education recommended the establishment of DIET. Then the next question, which of the following commission or committee was recorded exclusively to address teacher education in India?
Justice Varma Commission?
Chattopadhyay Commission?
Which one? Some noises are there.
Option 3, Chattopadhyay Commission.
It's okay, what is the answer?
Justice Varma Commission.
Yes, Justice Varma Commission is the correct answer. Justice Varma Commission got exclusively to address the teacher education in India. And then the next one. According to NCF 2005, the salient guiding principles of curriculum development include. இதுல நாலு ஆப்ஷன்ஸ் கொடுத்துருக்குறோம் என்னன்னா கனெக்டிங் நாலேஜ் டு லைஃப் அவுட் சைட் த ஸ்கூல் என்ஷூரிங் தட் த லேர்னிங் சிப்ஸ் அவே ஃப்ரம் ரோட் மெத்தட்ஸ் என்ரிச்சிங் கரிக்குலம் பியாண்ட் டெக்ஸ்ட் புக்ஸ் இன்டர்ஃபேஸிங் வித் மெடிக்கல் மாடல் ஆஃப் டிசபிலிட்டி ஃபோக்கஸ் ஆன் தி ஃபோக்கஸிங் ஆன் த டாமினன்ட் கல்ச்சர் ஸோ யூ கேன் சூஸ் த மோஸ்ட் அப்ரோப்ரியேட் ஆன்சர் ஃப்ரம் த ஆப்ஷன்ஸ் கிவன் பிலோ Anybody?
A, B, and C.
Option 4, A, B, and C.
A, B, and C. And yes, yes, correct, correct answer. Very good, very good. A, B, C is the correct answer. Connecting knowledge to life outside the school and ensuring that the learning shifts away from rote memory, sorry, rote method. Then the enriching curriculum beyond textbook. These are all the three guiding principles. In the curriculum development, included in the curriculum development, according by the NCU. These are the questions already out by the UGC, University Grant Commission, during the year 2019 and 20 itself, okay? Then the second area, policies and education. Here, what is meant by policy? Anybody know? So, okay, policy is a set of principles or rules to guidelines of standards to guide decisions and achieve rational outcomes by the organization. Then it is related to education also because the government of India appointed various committees and commissions in education sector to look about the curriculum, textbook review, evaluation process, then teaching methods, teacher trainings, etc. Since pre-independent India. So these covers a broad area of education system, that is to know the existing of the education system, then to understand the defects of existing system. To analyze these aspects, then they can create policies based after the independence, they can create a lot of policies are there. So the policies that means the government of India launched operation, for example, Operation Blackboard program in 1986, and the Learning Without Burden, the NCF National Curriculum Framework 2005, reduced the curriculum load based on the report of Ace World Committee titled the Learning Without Burden. These are the policies created by the commissions and committees and also implemented by the government of India. So this the policies and education. So here the relations with the policies and education, policy education relationship already known, so the time consumption I skip the points. Then the national development, the another important area, one is national development. Education also provide more importance to the development of our nation. Here there is six indicators of national development. That is GDP, one is GDP, gross domestic product. Then second one is PCE, per capita income. Then HDI, human development index, literacy rate, life expectancy, and infant mortality rate. So these are all the major indicators of national development. And also six factors also included. That means equal living standard for all, then equal share of profit in all, equal distribution of income and capital to the people, to the nation, preservation of environment, then expansion of facilities regarding education, health, social welfare, and shelter. These are all the factors responsible for the development of our nation. And also these are all, these factors are linked in national development and education systems also. For example, human resources, economic development, social resources, then scientific development, innovations. These are all the causes or factors were responsible for the development of our nation. So education also give more importance to play a role, vital role for the development of our nation. Then the determinants. So here there are six determinants. That means factors are responsible for the educational policies in it. Policies, that means the society, economy, culture, then parental education, physical facilities, political aspects. These are all aspects that determine the development of the nation and also creating the policies, educational policies. And the process of policy, there are six, I think, seven processes are there. There is only five for the numbers, but the seven process or steps of policy formulation. One is analysis of existing situation, either based upon the background of the country, politics, economics, then dynamic change, then educational, the context of educational sector. These are all aspects included in the analysis of existing situation. Then the second step, generation of policy options. The options may be selected based upon the systematic way or ad hoc way, mode or important important methods or any techniques we can follow to generate the policy option. Then the third step, evaluation. After the policy is generated, then we can move to the evaluation of policy options. What are the policies we have to evaluate? Then the fourth step, making the policy decision. Then fifth, planning of policy implementation, how to plan the policy to implement the society. Then the sixth one, policy impact assessment. Then we can assess it is worth or not. Then if in but the kudiya cost amount was in a mukha three apuna return out of the other same time society can be useful. So other than a sudang apna cost benefit analysis. Then second, cost effective analysis. So resources to the site. Yang look on the Balamaga, Mula Dharamaga said, hopefully, then cost effective analysis. Then economic returns to hire the government of India sanctioned 21,000 crore rupees for SSST service 6 beyond, but they then they expect the monetary benefit. But there only the government of India spent 21,000 crore rupees. So that means the economics, the higher development of higher education. That means scheme, any other scheme also. Then signaling theory, it means incentive to the students to motivate the higher education or any educational aspect, higher education, even higher education also. Then human capital theory, it means human capital. The human capital அப்படிங்கிறது அவங்கள்ட்ட இருக்கக்கூடிய வளங்கள் இண்டிவிஜுவல்ட்ட இருக்கக்கூடிய வளங்களை அவங்க எல்லாருக்குமே அதை வந்து என்ன பண்றது யூட்டிலைஸ் பண்ணக்கூடிய ஒரு இது அது வந்து ஒரு கோட்பாடு தான் என்ன சொல்றாங்க அப்படின்னா ஹியூமன் கேபிட்டல் அந்த ஹியூமன் மனிதன்ட்ட இருக்கக்கூடிய கேபிட்டல் ஒட்டுமொத்த அந்த வளங்கள் அது வந்து த்ரூ எக்கனாமிக் பேஸ்டா இருக்கலாம் காஸ்ட் பேஸ்டா இருக்கலாம் இல்ல ரிசோர்ஸ் பேஸ்டா இருக்கலாம் ஸோ அதை பேஸ் பண்ணி சொல்லக்கூடிய தியரி தான் நமக்கு வந்து ஹியூமன் கேபிட்டல் தியரி அப்படிங்கிறது Then educational finance, it's a micro and macro. There is two types of education finances are there. One is micro and one macro. Then micro level planning based upon the community based and village based. Then macro level, it is through the nation. And for macro, that means spending for RMSA scheme, SSC scheme. They will spend a lot of amount throughout the nation. That is the macro level planning, educational finance. Students of the school area. So these are all the aspects. Budgeting means finance also the annual budget or monthly budget or financial budgets. Financial budgets also. Even financial budgets we can plan for the throughout the academic session. So these are the aspects, economics of education aspect. There are lots of questions. Most of the I think. Within two examinations, they can ask 12 questions related to this area. For the first one is developing brand and enhancing marketing's emphasis by which law, which theory? Do you know? சிக்னல் தியரி ஆர் ஹியூமன் கேபிட்டல் தியரி ஆர் ரேஷனல் சாய்ஸ் அது என்ன பேங்க் அந்த அக்கவுண்ட் மட்டும் சொன்னா போதும் சோ தி ஆன்சர் இஸ் சிக்னல் தியரி ஓகே தி சிக்னல் தியரி டெவலப்பிங் பிராண்ட் அண்ட் என்ஹான்சிங் மார்க்கெட்டிங் எஃபிஷியன்சி தென் தி செகண்ட் क्वेश्चन தி ஹியூமன் கேபிட்டல் தியரி கிவ்ஸ் எம்ஃபசைஸ் ஆன் டாஸ் Anybody say the answer?
Income
okay, so the answer is...
Income.
Yes, very good. Income and expenditure is the essential component of budget. Okay, then very good. Then the while preparing the budget, which of the following points are considered to be mandatory? For budget, we are going to do the points that we are going to consider. The options are given for revenue, objectives of the institution, expenditure, community involvement, and teacher salary.
Fourth option.
Fourth, I think C, D, and C, expenditure, community involvement, and teacher salary. Wrong, that's not a reasonable answer.
That's
right,
sir. Revenue.
What? Yes, second one is very good. Revenue, objectives of the institution and the expenditure. The answer is second one. The three things are mandatory for preparing the budget. For a budget, okay. Then the next question, which of the following statement related to human capital theory? Okay, so the statement is for it is aggregate stock of competencies, knowledge, social and personal attributes. These are the things related to the human capital theory. Okay, then second option is correct. Then the next one below are given some general steps for undertaking cost-benefit analysis. Could you find?
Sir, option two.
Option? Two, yes, very good, very good. Two. Option two is correct. D, A, B, and C. Okay, very good. The next one, identify the specific features associated with macro level financing. எது வந்து நமக்கு வந்து மேக்ரோ லெவல் ஃபினான்சிக்கு வந்து நமக்கு வந்து துணையா இருக்கக்கூடியது.
ஆப்ஷன் 3 CEFNG.
ஓகே, தி ஆன்சர் 1 ஃபார் டோட்டல் எக்கானமி பேஸ்ட் கான்செப்ட். Option one, using chain of activity, then time frame specified, and minimum scope for risk. These are all the features associated with the macro level financing. So these are all the questions related to the economic and education. Okay, then the last aspect, politics and education. Here they mentioned the relationship between politics and education, then approaches of understanding politics. That three theories given. One is behaviorism, theory of system analysis, and theory of rational choice. These three theories are given under the politics and education aspect. And also then another one important aspect, education for political development and political socialization. So these are all the things given in the politics and education. Yeah, so politics politics and education every individual must have a member of the political party. So politics and education are coincident, interrelated one. Here the time constraint, we can discuss the questions only. Based upon the questions under the politics and education, the university grant commission asked the question from the during the year 2020. From the following list, identify those which are relevant for the theory of rational choice. So anybody can identify the answer, or could you find out the answer? So the answer is two. One is arrange aggregation of social behavior, then determinants of behavior, then predictions of behavior, and behavior problems associated with the information. These things are identified for the relevant for the theory of rational choice. Then the last question, which of the following statement most appropriately describes the concept of political modernization? Political modernization. Okay, the answer is general process of change in the political sphere is closely related to other areas of the society. This is the answer. I think in Excel, the points given to you based upon the unit 2, politics, economics, and commissions, I have prepared a lot of notes. I will provide the notes to the coordinators. They will share to you. Okay. So thank you all the participants for patiently listen this session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yeah, and sorry for some interruptions for the.
That is network issue. We couldn't do anything. Is it? Thank you so much, sir. Thank you.
Internet.
But session. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay, ma'am.
Thank you, sir. Yeah, dear participants, the next session starts immediately, okay? Already, the resource
person for... Okay, thank you, madam.
Thank you so much, sir.
Yes. Okay.
Any more, sir?
Okay, thank you, madam. Thank you. Okay, thank you, madam. Okay, thank you, madam. I thank the management.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you so much, sir.
Shall I leave? Okay, ma'am. Okay. Shall I leave, ma'am?
Okay, you can leave. Okay, ma'am. Okay, sir, you can leave.
Okay, thank you. Thank you, madam.
So, Supriya, ma'am. Good morning.
Good morning, everyone gathered here.
Good morning, ma'am.
Good morning, ma'am. Good morning to all. Good morning, all the NET aspirants. Shall I share my presentation?
Let me introduce you, ma'am, first.
Okay.
I am happy to introduce the resource person, Dr. R. Sasi Priya. She is working as an assistant professor of physical science at VOC College of Education, Thoothukudi, since 2008. She has guided 4 MPhil scholars and 13 MEd scholars. She has completed a minor project for SSA Chennai in 2012 and has applied for many research projects. She has organized national workshops and seminars sponsored by UGC and the College of Management. She is an approved guide of Tamil Nadu Teacher Education University, Chennai. She is the initiator and editor of Ma'am, your voice is not audible, ma'am. Ma'am?
Ma'am, we couldn't hear you, ma'am.
Okay, thank you so much, ma'am. I am very happy to meet you all in this NET coaching program organized by the St. Ignatius College of Education. I thank you so much, the management, principal, and teaching faculty, and all the NET aspirants for join this session. Okay, now I share my presentation.
Sure, ma'am.
Here in this session, we will discuss the Unit 5 Curriculum Studies. The Unit 5 Curriculum Studies. Here, before we starting this session, we will discuss the detailed analysis of the paper 2. What are the previous questions asked in the UGC NET examination in the exam June-September 2020. Here from the first unit, 9 questions were asked, educational from the unit, education studies, and 3 questions from the history, politics, and economics of education. Next, 14 questions from learner and learning process. Then, 16 questions from teacher education, 8 questions from curriculum studies, and 12 questions from research in education, 3 questions from pedagogy, andragogy, and assessment, questions from technology in education, 11 questions from educational management, administration, and leadership. Then the last one, 6 questions from inclusive education. This is the detailed analysis of the paper 2 for the education paper. Here, from curriculum studies, totally 8 questions were asked. That is one question from the topic concept of curriculum development, 2 questions from curriculum design, then 1 question from the development of a curriculum, 2 from the models of curriculum design, 1 from the types of curriculum, and 1 from the types of curriculum change. Next, I hope all of you having your syllabus and go through your syllabus. Here I'm not going to read this syllabus. This curriculum studies have the 3 parts. Part A, the concept of curriculum and the principles, determinants, and foundations, etc., etc. And part B, it includes the models of curriculum design, that is the various models. Then part C, it included the curriculum change and types of curriculum change. I hope you all well know this syllabus. Here, let me discuss the etymological meaning of the curriculum. The curriculum is not only for the NET aspirants, but basically the teachers or the teacher educators have the well knowledge about the curriculum. Here, the etymology means, that is the origin, the word, the origin of the word. The origin of the word is that it is the path or a way. It is a path or a way. That is, in a classical Latin, it is called as a running. That is, the term curriculum has been derived from the Latin word curre, which means a race course, that is a runway on which one runs to reach him. That is, curriculum is a tool in the hands of an artist. Here, the artist represents the teacher to mold his material, that is, that material represents the peoples according to his ideals, that is, the ideals represents the objectives in his studio, that is, the educational institutions. So, curriculum is a tool in the hands of an artist to mold his material according to his ideals in his studio. So, we can say that from these definitions, it comprises the experiences of children, then it has a content, it is planned, it is a series of courses to be taken by the students. Then the next important thing is that there are the various types of curriculum. Various here, only six types is listed. First one is the overt, explicit or written curriculum. Overt means something outside, it other which is seen inside, that is, most of the books and workbooks, the workbooks contain, apart from the curriculum in the books, and some digital materials, these are called as the overt curriculum. That is, the curriculum contained in the books, workbooks and other digital web pages and URL and etc. This is overt curriculum or explicit curriculum or written curriculum. The second type is the hidden or covert curriculum. Hidden means that is something can be happened inside, which is not seen in the outside. That is a hidden curriculum. Some very traditional institution and highly disciplined institutions, they follow some ethics and values inside the institutions. They cannot seen outside. That is that institution used to ensure the punctuality, used to ensure the academic knowledge, and used to ensure the strict discipline, and used to have some ensure some values and skills. That is called the hidden curriculum. The third one is the societal curriculum. That is, the societal curriculum is it is in informal nature. The learning experience from the society, that is the elders, the neighbors, the friends, and the members in the streets, or sometimes the learning experience from the religious places, temple, mosque, and churches. This is called the societal curriculum. The another one is the null curriculum. Sometimes some portions are not attended by the teachers, because due to the some time factor or other things, and give the preference to the some other portions that time, that is called the null curriculum, that is, which is not attended by the teachers and in the exam point of view, and give some importance to the other portions, that is null curriculum. The another one is the concomitant curriculum. Concomitant curriculum, that is, the children can learn from their own family members within the four walls. That is, the relations in the relations in the family. They can learn some values. And as many times the elders and the family members and the parents give directions and advice to the children. that is, it may be indirectly or in the indirectly way. That curriculum is called concomitant curriculum. The next one is the rhetorical curriculum. This curriculum is developed by the policy makers. Recently our government announced a national education policy. It is developed by the government, and we follow that curriculum. We have some guidelines from the NEP. That is the rhetorical curriculum. That type of curriculum is called rhetorical curriculum. Then another one interesting topic is the what are the characteristics of a good curriculum. The curriculum should have some characteristics. The first characteristics is that it is a well balanced. That is, well balanced means it should develop the all round personality development of the learners. That is, the curriculum should develop the physical development, emotional development, intellectual development, and social development, and skill development. So the curriculum should be well balanced. The another one is the curriculum should be demanding and difficult. The curriculum should updated based on the society needs. Society needs or the nation developments. The curriculum should include some new area based on our development of our nation. So sometimes it is very demand and somewhat it is difficult. Then the next one is the coherent. Coherent means it has the clear objectives. The curriculum should have the clear objectives. That objectives is rational and it should be intelligible. So the curriculum should be coherent. The next one is the integrated curriculum. It may be the vertically integrated or it is horizontally integrated. That is, vertically integrated means in science textbooks from sixth standard, the students are studying some measurement devices, screw gauge, vernier caliper, and a physical balancer. But they are studying in the sixth standard. They have the practical session in the ninth or 10th standard. This is the vertical curriculum. The horizontal curriculum means, suppose the students are studying the theory portion in the sixth standard, after one within the same year they will have some practical experiences. It is called as a integrated curriculum. Another one is the curriculum should be appropriate. That is, appropriate for the learners. It should be appropriate for the environment. It should be appropriate for the needs and interests of the learners. Then it should be focused. It should be focusing to develop the successful person, and it is relevant. That is, it may be pertinent or it may be significant. These are some characteristics of a good curriculum. When the curriculum makers keep in mind these characteristics in the process of developing curriculum. The next thing is what is the basis for the basis of curriculum. The basis of curriculum means these parameters influences the curriculum. The first one is the human development. When the human, always the human development influencing the curriculum. That is, the technology updation and other things, transport, and everything is changes. So human development is also influencing the curriculum. Then the social forces, recently we are facing the COVID-19 pandemic situations. This social forces influencing the curriculum. We are gathered to the online platform for our education. So we need some updation in the curriculum. So social forces also influencing the curriculum. The nature of knowledge and cognition based on the social forces and based on the human development. The nature of knowledge and cognition is also differed. It also influencing the curriculum and the nature of learning. Before that, we are doing the traditional learning in the offline campuses, and we have used the various methods. But today we are using the lot of electronic gadgets. That is the digital, we follow the digital learning. So the nature of learning is also influencing the curriculum. These are the basis of the curriculums. We keep it in our mind. Then, what are the things determine the curriculum? What are the things determine the curriculum? These are the basic things determine the curriculum. One is the basic needs. Basic needs means basic needs of the learners, basic needs of the teacher, basic needs of the environment. And basic needs, the students, students' interest, students' capabilities, students' responsibilities. These are the things determine the curriculum. Then the social aspects of our environment and social factors also determine the curriculum. Then every time we speak about a curriculum, curriculum preserve our culture. So cultural factors also determine the curriculum. Then individual talents, individuality, this also determine the curriculum. Sometimes the students have the double promotion and other things, they have some acceleration. In every classrooms, we have the average students and below average students and above average students. So the curriculum should meet the individual talents of the all the students. So it should based on the individual talents of the learners. Then ideas, intellectual, it should be determined by the intellectual, moral, aesthetics and religious factors. Then the curriculum determined by the traditional factors of the society. These are the determinants of the curriculum. In your curriculum studies, you need 5 syllabus. The next one is the, this is the very important thing, the development of the curriculum process. This is the development of the curriculum process. It includes what are the stages, stages in the curriculum development. First one is the selection of aims, selection of goals, aims and objectives. Selection of goals, aims and objectives. So the curriculum planner fix the goals of the curriculum and the goals leads to the aims, and the aims leads to some objectives, that is general objectives and specific objectives. So the curricular planner first select the goals, aims and objectives. After selecting the aims, goals, objectives, the curricular planners select the learning experiences, various learning experiences. What are the learning, in what way we give the inputs to the learners? So select the learning experiences. Then the third stage, the selection of content. Which content is suitable for this learning experiences? Selection of the content, the suitable content is selected, and appropriate learning experience is matched to the selection of the content. Then organize and integrate the learning experiences and content. What are the learning experiences you choose? What are the content you choose? You organize the content and you integrate the learning experience and the content, which one is the most appropriate and a suitable one. And finally, to evaluate the curriculum. To evaluate the curriculum, if it needs any updation or any modification, you revise the objectives and other things. You revise the objectives, you maybe revise the learning experience and you revise the selection of the content, and again you integrate the learning experience and content. So it is a cyclic process. The curriculum development is a cyclic process. This is the cycling process of the curriculum development. The next thing is the principles of curriculum constructions. The next thing is that we are keeping in our mind the various principles in the curriculum constructions. Every curricular developer should keep these principles of curriculum constructions. The first principle is the principles of child-centeredness. Principle of child-centeredness, because the child is the most important in the curriculum. Principle of child-centeredness, so the curriculum should be child is under, it means that what is to be given children in the form of learning experiences at a particular age and grade. So curriculum should properly suit their age, abilities, capabilities, interest, and the mental development and the previous experiences. So the curriculum should fulfill the needs and requirement of developing the children. So the curriculum developer keep the principle of child-centeredness. The child is belongs to the community. So the next one is the principle of community-centeredness. Community contributes a lot in building the future of the young generation. That is, the children may learn a lot through the various useful and relevant resources available in the community. The next one is the principle of activity-centeredness. The principle of the child, children are quite active by nature. So we always kept the children busy in the classroom and give lot of activities to them. The children always take interest and pay attentions that is towards the various learning experiences and various activities. That is, they are very interesting in the learning by doing. So lot of activities should be included in the part of the curriculum. The next one is the principle of variation. When the principle of activity centeredness comes, the variety of activity included in the curriculum, the variety of activity included in the curriculum. Then principle of coordination and integration. All the activities and the content is coordinated and integrated. Then the next one is the principle of conservation. The conserve the culture and promote the culture. Promote the culture of the society. The next one is the principle of creativity to develop creativity among the young learners. That is the principle of creativity. The next one is the principle of forward looking. Principle of forward looking is this curriculum is not suitable for this time only. We are looking forward after a decade or after a two decade. So the curriculum should be the forward looking. Today's education is the tomorrow's prospecting. So principle of forward looking should be followed by the curriculum planners. And another one is the principle of flexibility. The curriculum should not be rigid. It should be flexible according to time to time. Next, the principle of balance. The curriculum should be balanced with the emotional, physical, intellectual, and various skill development among the learners. The last one is the principle of utility. And the principle of utility is very, very important. That is, whatever the students learn in the classroom, it is useful for their life. That is a principle of utility. That is, it can be used for their life situations. So the principle of utility is very, very important for the curriculum construction. So these are the principles of curriculum construction. We must keep in mind to when you develop the curriculum, you use all the principles. The next one is the some factors are interrelated with the curriculum, some parameter. When you develop a while you are developing a curriculum, you must concentrate the nature of discipline. That is, the nature of discipline means the nature of subject. You must concentrate the nature of subject. According to the nature of subject, the nature of subject and the curriculum is an interrelated one. And the social considerations and the curriculum is an interrelated one. Then the teacher-related factor. Sometimes when the curriculum is changing, the teacher should update their knowledge. When we are coming from the offline to the online, the teacher should develop the knowledge to handle the ICT and social media and other digital skills. So these are the teacher related factors. then the institutional considerations. While you are constructing a curriculum, you may concentrate the institution also, because you include some curriculum, the institution have not some facilities. Suppose a school wants to introduce the robotics as a subject, but it may not have a robotics lab. The curriculum should consider the institution also, and some environmental and economic consideration. Curriculum interrelated with the environmental and economic considerations and developmental considerations. The latest inventions and latest developments also included in the curriculum. So the curriculum can change the latest developments and the latest developments also influencing the curriculum. These are some some factors related with the curriculum. The next one is here we discuss what are the stages of the curriculum development. What are the stages of a curriculum development? First stage is the planning. In the planning stage, the curriculum planner develop the vision. It may be the 5-year plan, and it may be the 10-year plan, or it may be the 3-year plan. The curriculum is used for 3 years. Once 3 year, it can be changed. That is the planning. So first the curriculum developers concentrate the planning, then the preparation. The preparations are based on the curriculum, based on the philosophical foundations and some psychological and sociological. This is these philosophies and all isms, the idealism, naturalisms, and all these things included in the preparation of the curriculum, and also the student psychology and other things are included in the curriculum. The social factors also included in the curriculum. So the curriculum planners, before after planning, they are preparing through the philosophy, psychology, and environmental factors and the social factors. Then designing means there is a what are the objectives and what are the learning experiences and what are the content and how can you integrate the content and the learning experiences. Once you design the curriculum, you can develop the content in a systematic and organized manner, and the curriculum and after developing it should be implemented. When it is implemented, it can be evaluated. After evaluating, the drawbacks are revised, then it can be improved. So these are the stages of curriculum, the curriculum development. So it needs a vision, and the future. Keep in mind the future of the nation. So these are the stages of the curriculum development. Then these things also involves in the curriculum development process. The content, that is the content should be abstractness. That is it should be the unbiased. The curriculum should be very simplicity. It has a simple language that it can be easily understood by the teachers and the learners. It should have some extracurricular topics. That is not only study the content given in the syllabus and given in the curriculum. It must be included some extracurricular topics to arouse the interest among the learners. And to develop some extra knowledge among the learners, to encourage the students, some extracurricular topics are included. Sometimes some teachers or some lecturers included in their included some topics related to their curriculum and syllabus. The next one is it gives the curriculum should explain the lifetime situations. The students can solve the live examples also. The second one is the process. After developing the content, the process is that it should develop the higher order thinking among the children. The process means it is the teacher and student interaction process, how you transfer the material to your students. So that interaction process should develop the higher order thinking among the learners. That transaction through inquiry. So the teacher should give the ample opportunities to the students to develop the inquiry and find the solutions of the problem. So it infuses the inquiry based learning, and the teachers give the open-ended experiences, and also it can be flexible, and it facing variety, that is at any time and anywhere the student can learn, the student can develop their knowledge. Another important factor is the learning environment. The learning environment must be flexible. It is not a rigid. It is time to time changing. The teachers and the society provide the flexible environment to the students depending on the nature. And another one is a high mobility. High mobility means the students can learn in any places. The students can learn from the books. The students can learn from the websites. The students can learn from the some URLs, and the students can learn from the, that is the ICT enabled learning. And the learning environment, it should be the learner centered. The independent learner centered, the students should have a lot of opportunities and learning by doing, and open flexible grouping. Then the final one is the product in the curriculum process, that is feedback and evaluation. Based on the evaluations, transformation should be given to improve the curriculum transaction. Next, we will discuss about the curriculum development phases. We will discuss about the curriculum development phases. There are the three curriculum development phases. One is the instructional development. Instructional development means it have the goals, aims, and objectives of the curriculum. Then the media and material development. The media is the learning learning experience, and the material development, it is the content, what are the equipments, and what are the media and platform used for this materials. That is the various resources are used for this curriculum, and methods of teaching, various methods of teaching included in the curriculum development phases, and testing. So there are the three phases in the curriculum development. One is the instructional development, another one is the media and material development, the next one is the methods of teaching and testing. Here we comes to meet the what are the major foundations of curriculum. What are the major foundations of the curriculum? The curriculum involves the four major foundations. First one is the philosophical foundations, then the next one is the psychological foundations, historical foundations, and social foundations. Here historical foundations, that is this refer to those influences on the curriculum that are derived from the developments in the past. They form the basis for decision making and the systematic growth of the education system. The next one is the sociological foundations of the curriculum. That is the curriculum designer. The curriculum designer is actually dealing with the cultural values and social needs and the learners' backgrounds. So the curriculum learners should concentrate the social needs and the learners' background. It comes under the social foundations of the curriculum. And the another one is the philosophical foundations of the curriculum. That means it constitute the values and beliefs that make up the philosophies of life and of education. That is, it influences other foundations also. So sometimes idealism, it carries ideas than the objects. And naturalism, pragmatism, it focuses the life situations of the learners. These things comes under philosophical foundations. The next one is the psychological foundations. The psychological, the learning experience, that is the capability of the learner, the maturation of the other, the maturation level, the capability of the learners and the maturation level of the learners, that is the maturity of the learners, and the rate of the learning, that is the students, how well, how can they learn, the rate of the learning. These things are considered and systematically organize the sequence, organize the curriculum, that is in sequence, organize and methodology, methodology and some behavioral behavioral programs. So these things are comes under the psychological foundations of the curriculum. The next one, we have to discuss the some models of curriculum design. So the curriculum models, this curriculum models, first one is the based on the learning theories. Learning theories, there are the four curriculum models. One is the information processing and social interaction, personal development and behavior modifications. And behavior modifications. So the first one is the information process, information processing theory. Information Hilda Daba profounded the inductive thinking. That is to make the children to develop their thinking. That is the teacher provide the situations or opportunities to the children to find the solution for the problem. That is the inductive thinking. It is profounded by the Hilda Daba. He is a school teacher. He was a school teacher. Then sometimes the self direction of the learners may go in a wrong way. So the concept attainment model is developed by the Jerome Bruner. Here the concept attained by the learner by the teachers. The concept attained by the learner with the help of the teachers. That is the concept attainment model. This is developed by Jerome Bruner. The next one is the scientific inquiry. This is developed by the Joseph Schwab. Scientific inquiry. It is develops scientific thinking and a scientific scientific attitude among the learners. That is the children kept in the place of a researcher. The researcher, so they can develop their knowledge based on this scientific inquiry. Then Richard Schuchman developed the model inquiry training model. This inquiry training model is also the questioning from the questioning basis. It is self developed by the students. The next one is the mnemonics. Mnemonics by Michael Priestley. Mnemonics means we keep the large statements and a lot of things. How we keep the lot of things in the mind. That is, it is the mind techniques. That is the mnemonics. The mnemonics is developed by the Michael Priestley. The another one is the synaptics. So synaptics is the creativity. What are the creativity? How creativity develop among the children? William Gordon introduced the model synaptics, and David Ausubel introduced the advanced organizer model. These things comes under the information processing theory. The another one is the social interaction. Social interaction means social groups. That is social interaction. It is a partners in learning. So this may be a group discussion, and this may be a project work, and other things. According to this theory, the David and Roger Johnson introduced the positive interdependence theory. Then the next one is the Robert Salvin introduced the structured inquiry. It is also a group investigation, role playing by the Fanny Saffel, and a jurisprudential inquiry developed by Donald Oliver and James Saber. Why I keep these things in the slides, because the questions are based, come from the in the types of a curriculum and the basis of the curriculum and the curriculum models in each and every topic. The questions may come, so the NET aspirants detailly analyze all the topics and what are the things you cross through this topics. These are the basic things. Then the personal development, it has the two categories. It is very familiar to everyone. That is the first one, so Carl Rogers, non-directive teaching. Another one is everyone, the familiar one. It is the Abraham Maslow's self-esteem. The next one is the behavior modification. Mastery learning is developed by Benjamin Bloom and James Block. The next one, Tom Good and Jerry Propi developed the direct instruction, and Carl Smith, profounded simulation theory, and Albert Bandura profounded social learning theory, and the program learning is developed by the that is the linear programming and the branching programming developed by B.F. Skinner and Crowder. Here it is a simple model, and it is a common model. That is the Tyler's curriculum development in a part B. You see your syllabus, you have some models. So first one is the Tyler's model, Tyler's curriculum development model. It is a classical model. So here the sources, sources is the learning resources. It is influenced by the society, and the sources influenced by the learners, the sources influenced by the subject matter. Then based on this, the curricular developers develop the tentative objectives. That tentative objectives put under the light of philosophy, psychology, and sociology, and historical backgrounds. Then they formulate the precise objectives. Based on this precise objectives, select the learning experiences, and the learning experiences may be evaluated. And if any modification needed, again we formulate the objectives and other these things. This is a common model for the common model, and it is the simplest curricular model. The next one is that, how can you organize a curricular content? These things follow to organize the curricular content. The first one is the logical. A logical means it is a simple to complex. The curriculum should be arranged in a simple to complex manner. It is something different from the psychological. That is, in the psychological, it means it is known to unknown. You can have the logical arrangement and psychological arrangement. Logical arrangement is the simple to complex. The subject matters move from the simple to complex. And the psychological, it is move from the known to unknown, unknown matters. These two things have something different. And also spiral, that the content have some breadth. It is a spiral, spirally look. It has some breadth and concentrate, and it has some breadth and the deep knowledge. It should include the breadth and the deep knowledge. Then we already seen the what is the horizontal and what is the vertical. So it may be arranged in the horizontal, or sometimes it may be arranged in the vertical form. That is, the student can study in the sixth standard, and again the its advancement in the seventh, and again its advancement in the eighth standard. This may go. This is the organizing the curricular content. The next one is the part to whole. That is to develop the inductive thinking among the learners. That is part to whole. The next one is the whole to part. It is to develop the deductive thinking among the learners. Sir. Though this way the curriculum should be organized. The curriculum should be organized. The next one is the what are the interdependence of the curriculum components? The objectives and contents. These two things are interdependent. When the what are the objectives? Based on the objectives, the content should be formulated, and based on the objectives, the methods frame, and based off the content, the methods frame, and here evaluation based on the content, based on the method, the evaluation occur. And objectives, based on the objectives, the evaluation occur. These parameters are interdependence of each other, that is the interrelation of each other. These are called the curriculum components. Now, what are the curricular components? Objectives, content, method, and evaluation. These are the interrelated to each other. Then next, we come across some models of curriculum evaluation. First one, you have seen the curriculum development model. In the part C, you cross some models of curriculum evaluation. Here, a lot of curriculum models are there, but for in your NET syllabus, you have only the four curriculum evaluation models. What are they? The Scrivens goal-free model. The Scrivens goal-free model, 1970, and Taylor's objective model. Then stakes matrix for processing descriptive data. The another one is the Stoffel-Beams CIPP model. Stoffel-Beams CIPP model. Here, first one is the Scrivens goal-free model. Evaluators, that is the evaluators. The goals and objectives are not to be influenced by the curriculum developers. So here the evaluator, the totally independent. This is here the methodology is open for judging any aspect of the curriculum. This is a Scrivens goal-free model. It is developed in the year 1970. These are the things, evaluation model. The another one is the Taylor's objective model. The Taylor's objective model, when the based, this deals with evaluating the effectiveness of a plan and actions, and it should be evaluated in relation to its pre-specified set of objectives, and it evaluate measures fit between the student performance and objective, and the methodology will depend on the evaluator's definitions of measurements. Based on the things, the Taylor's objectives model discusses the following things. Another one is the Stoffel-Beam CIPP model. That is, the C means context, I means input, P means process, and another P is the product. This is the CIPP model. It is a model of curriculum evaluation. It's a process to see the effectiveness of the developed and implemented curriculum. This model is used to see the effectiveness of the developed and the implemented curriculum. The next one is that here we come to the part C. Approaches of curriculum evaluation. Approaches of curriculum evaluation. These are the approaches of a curriculum evaluation. That is, the approaches means it is a way of dealing with something, a way of doing or thing, a way of doing or thinking about something. The first one is the brochaic evaluation. That is, this evaluation is usually initiated by the government or the Ministry of Education. That is, the Ministry of Education could evaluate the course of study or subjects taught in schools and the educational institutions to find out whether they need improvement or modifications. This is called the brochaic evaluation. The another one is the autocratic evaluation. That is, this evaluation focuses on what is considered to be the educational needs of a curriculum. Here, the governments and ministries ask the independent evaluators, that is, such as consultants, to conduct this evaluation. This is called as the autocratic evaluation. The another one is the democratic evaluation, that this focuses on the experiences and reaction the curriculum initiators, that is they had some project and through the project they evaluated. In this approach, the evaluator does not lead to firm recommendations that is considered by the initiators or the program implementers. The another one is the norm-referenced evaluation. Norm-referenced evaluation, that is, it evaluates the student's performance relative to other students' performance. That is the performance of current students or the previous students, they can be compared. The next one is the criterion-referenced evaluation. The criterion-referencing measures students' actual performance and compares it with the objectives of instructions identified in the syllabus. This is the criteria. These things are the approaches of curriculum evaluation. The next one is the curriculum change. That is the curriculum change or the curriculum revision. That means the making the curriculum different in some way. That is to give in a new position or a new direction. Sometimes there is a change, there is an alteration to its philosophy, that is the alteration to its philosophy, in aims and objectives, and reviewing the content and revising the methods and rethinking the evaluator process. That time we need the curriculum curriculum change, and here we are going to discuss some types of curriculum change. What are the types of curriculum change? First one is the planned change. That is, the planned change means who are involved of the equal power. That is, equal power means other people who are involved in this curriculum change, they have the equal power. That is the planned change. It is clear what everyone needs to do. The next one is the coercion forced change. This type of change has a serious and imbalance of power, because one group determines the goal and has the power, and all other groups are excluded from the discussion and are expected to obey. So this is called as the coercion forced change. The another one is the interaction change. This approach involves equal amounts of power among all those who have an interest. The problem is in the communication and execution. This is the interaction change. And the another one is the natural and random change. Natural and random change means it is not planned without setting any goal and objectives. It just happens in the school level and also any educational institution, college level. Next, we will discuss about the what are the approaches of curriculum change. There are the three approaches. It is the last topic in your syllabus. There are the three approaches. One is the administrative approach. Another one is the grassroots approach. The third one is the demonstration approach. The administrative approach means in this approach, the school or college administrators make the first move. When he or she realizes the need for the curriculum development and to make the needed revisions. That time he arranges the faculty meetings.
Excuse me, ma'am. Sorry for the interruption. Time is exceeding, ma'am.
Within 2 minutes I will finish, ma'am. This is the last slide. Okay. So the grassroots approach, the grassroots approach, it is community wide. It embraces not only the teachers but also the students, parents and other members of the community. The last one is the demonstration of a approach. Here the purpose of this approach is to introduce changes in the regular program on a small scale, that is holding the disturbance of the faculty and the community to a minimum. This is the final slide of my presentation. Almost I cover all the topics, almost 80% of the topics I cover. I prepared some previous questions, and I will hand over the questions to the organizers. You will get from them. Okay. Thank you, ma'am.
Dear students, for your wonderful presentation, ma'am.
Yes, ma'am. Dear students, do you have any queries? Dear participants, okay, thank you. Thank you, Madan, and thank you, Sharmila. Thank you, ma'am. Clearing. Only one thing I want to share. Net clearance is very easy for the net aspirants if you have the meticulous plan for the study. If you have the meticulous plan for the study, you will achieve your net examination. So at this time, I wish all the net aspirants best wishes to you all to clear your net examination. And I once again thank the management, faculty members of St. Management, principal, and the faculty members of St. Ignatius College of Education for giving me this wonderful opportunity to meet you all this online forum. And I especially thank Dr. Indra Mary Elizabeth, ma'am. Thank you, one and all. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
Shall I leave, ma'am?
Yes, ma'am. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, ma'am.
The session will start at 2:15, sharp at 2:15. Thank you. You could leave and rejoin, okay? Thank you.